that through these amendments, the perpetrators of economic sabotage who have continually invaded punishment at the expense of the livelihoods of Filipino farmers may finally face prosecution commensurate to the damage caused by their actions, and that reinforced law may deter others who may aspire to pursue such extractive activities from following suit. I look forward to continuing our productive discussion and to listening to the valuable inputs of our distinguished members and resource persons. Thank you very much. So similar to how we conducted our technical working group during our last meeting, I will present section by section, provision by provision, the proposed amendments as well as the rationale or the basis for making such amendments. We've already incorporated here those items that were already agreed upon during our technical working group, so we will no longer go through them again because they're already incorporated. So what we will highlight today are those items that require deliberation still from the body, and second, the results of the MIF workshop conducted by the Committee on Agriculture and Food, DTI, and CC to harmonize some of the definitions that were left hanging during our last technical working group.
Go ahead.
Okay, so we'll then move to the summary of the proposed amendments. So these are the amendments that were incorporated into the current working draft that were discussed during the last TWG, as well as the new proposals that we have. First is revising the short title of RA10845. We'll present the proposed short title later on. Second is providing the definition of terms and expanding the list of agri-fishery commodities. Third is defining the acts that constitute cartelizing and other acts of market abuse. Fourth, simplifying the graduation of penalties to effectively increase sanctions and fines. Five, adding presumptions of smuggling, hoarding, profiteering, cartelizing, and other acts of market abuse. Six is establishing the Anti-Agri-Fishery Commodities and Tobacco Economic Sabotage Council. Seven is similarly establishing a task force. Eight is establishing a congressional oversight committee. Nine is expanding the list of agencies that can constitute cases. 10, establishing a special team of prosecutors within the DOJ. 11, extending the application of the prescriptive period. And 12 is expanding the list of agencies involved in the drafting of the implementing rules and regulations. We'll go through this one by one, very quick, we'll only very quickly discuss other points, and then we'll focus a chunk of our discussion on items 6 and 7 and 8, because those are the ones that are still open for deliberation during today's hearing. So for the first proposed amendment, so we've already, based on the inputs of the technical working group last hearing, we've incorporated fisheries into the discussion rather than just repeatedly saying agricultural commodities. So we've revised the short title to reflect that accordingly. So it would now be known as the Anti-Agri-Fishery Commodities and Tobacco Economic Sabotage Act. Next. Second is to provide a definition of terms and expanding the list. So also based off our previous technical working group, we've already incorporated all of the commodities that were proposed by the body, as well as changing the definition. So across the whole bill, you would no longer see agricultural commodities and fishery commodities separately. So we've clumped them together as agri-fisheries commodities and then tobacco. So just to make it easier. And then we've also now expanded that definition to incorporate both agricultural commodities and fishery commodities. Thank you.
Hindi ko makita yung nameplates na rin. Kasi seen yung confusion.
Yes, Mr. Kailet.
Mr. Sonan.
Yes.
Apologies. I'm unable to see the nameplates. Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Son.
Yeah, can we include the coconut oil, palm oil, wheat and corn and seeds?
Mr. Saul, just to clarify, so here you would like in A to include coconut oil, palm oil, and wheat.
Yeah, and wheat. And seeds.
And seeds. The others are okay. So coconut oil, palm oil, and wheat are all okay. We'll just like to ask more around seeds.
Yung seeds kasi ano, yung seeds is may mga seeds na dumadating na sasabihin nila seeds pero binebenta as rice. As kaya dapat zero tariff kasi yung seeds eh. So dapat included ang seeds.
Okay. So with regard to the seeds, selling it off as rice, even if it's imported as seeds, is already considered misdeclaration and outright smuggling. So we won't cover it anymore under this, but we'll accept the proposal to include coconut oil, palm oil, and wheat. So we'll amend subsection A to include those parts.
Okay, thank you.
From the Office of the Solicitor General.
Yes, good morning, Madam Chair. I would like to apologize, but can we go back to Section 2? Just a minor suggestion. I understand it is a mere declaration of policy, but to be comprehensive to include agri-fishery, I would like to suggest on line 2, it should be productivity of the agriculture and fisher folk or fishery sector and to protect farmers and fisher folk. And then on the last paragraph, on the second line from the last, to protect the livelihood of our farmers and fisher folk. That would be all. Thank you.
Okay, noted on that. So we'll amend section 2 to read as follows. Declaration of policy with the balance of the state to promote the productivity of the agriculture and fishery sector. I think we should also include tobacco here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll further expand that to say it is the policy of the state to promote the productivity of the agriculture, fishery, and tobacco sector and to protect farmers from farmers and fisher folk from unscrupulous traders and importers who by their illegal importation of agri-fishery commodities, especially rice and tobacco, significantly affect the production, availability of supply, and stability of process and food security of the state. So to also further expand on the suggestion of the OSG, we'll include tobacco there as well. Thank you very much. Any other comments?
And lastly, Madam Chair, on the third paragraph, and to protect the livelihood of our farmers and fisher folk, and to ensure the economic well-being and that of consumers.
Noted on that. So the last paragraph shall read as the state shall impose higher sanctions for large-scale smuggling, hoarding, profiteering, cartelizing, and other acts of market abuse of agri-fishery commodities or tobacco, and to public officials or employees who take part in, tolerate, or consent the building of the same as a self-preservation measure to shield itself from the manipulative scheme of economic saboteurs and to protect the livelihood of our farmers and fisher folk and to ensure their economic well-being and that of consumers. Noted, accepted. Mr. Inchong, Attorney Inchong.
Magandang umaga po. Noong sa Section 4D on the definition of fair market value for imported commodities.
We'll move to that later on.
I'm sorry.
Before
na tayo, ma'am.
Section 1, 2, and 3 pa lang po.
May I just comment on the state shall promote the affordability of food. Can we include not only affordability to be consistent with the definition of food security under the UN United Nations definition of food security, stability of supply? Because when you say when you only stick to affordability, in practice po kasi sa policy making ng gobyerno, lalo na ng mga ekonomista, affordability means given the neglect of agriculture, automatically imported yan. It would pertain to importation. Whereas, if you include the term stability of supply, at least you are making reference and giving respect to local production as a source of stability. Kasi ma'am, and resiliency. Kasi ma'am, consistent naman yung ekonomista, yung NEDA, yung UP School of Economics, yung mga advocates niyan. Laging ang pinupush nila affordability with but remaining silent on the neglect of the sector. Eh, siyempre, pag tinabi mo kami dun sa sinusuportahan ng gobyerno nila, talo kami dun sa affordability. Kasi pinabayaan kami. Although, of course, the position of certain economies is that we were protected, which we dispute.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, ma'am.
Noted on that, Attorney Inchong, as this is also consistent with the President's 8-point socio-economic agenda, we'll amend that paragraph within Section 3 as follows. The state shall likewise promote the affordability and the stability of supply of food and other agri-fishery commodities for Filipino consumers by preventing large-scale smuggling, hoarding, profiteering, cartelizing, and other acts of market abuse that manipulate prices and unduly restrain supply.
Thank you, ma'am.
Noted and accepted. Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Cham.
Yes, with regard to the declaration of policy, can I suggest that we change the wording to as follows. It is a policy of the state to promote the productivity of the agriculture sector and to protect farmers from unscrupulous traders and smugglers, because importers should not be judged as illegal as smugglers. You know, they are legal importation, and all illegal importation is smuggling. So please, if we can change this to smugglers instead of using the word importers. Thank you.
Mr. Cham, if I may, because here we have unscrupulous as the adjective to refer to both traders and importers. That's the descriptive for the importers. Qualifier po natin. All right. Any other comments on sections 1 and 2 before we go back to section 3? Okay. So based on the suggestion of Mr. Saw, you can see here that we've already incorporated coconut oil, palm oil, and wheat in the definition. For B, this was a product of the workshop by the PCC, DTI, and the Committee on Agriculture and Food. So we've just enhanced the definition of economic activity here to read as follows. Economic activity refers, but not limited to, engagement in the production, manufacturing, processing, importation, storage, supply, distribution, marketing, trading, sale, or disposition of agri-fishery commodities. For tobacco. For C, this was a wording suggested by the PCC. So this is just to make it consistent across the whole bill. So entities refers to any person, natural or juridical, sole proprietorship, combination, or association in any form, whether incorporated or not, domestic or foreign, including those owned or controlled by the government, engaged directly or indirectly in any economic activity. And then here, This one actually was a point of contention during the previous technical working group as to how we will determine fair market value. So rather than defining it again and again in the different sections of our bill, we've decided to already here in the definition of terms define fair market value as different for imported commodities and domestically produced commodities. So based on the discussion in our last technical working group, fair market value will be defined for imported commodities as follows. Fair market value for imported commodities refers to the transaction value as determined by the Bureau of Customs in concurrence with the Department of Agriculture and the Department of Trade and Industry of the agri-fishery commodities or tobacco at the time of the commission of the crime. This was the decision during the last technical working group to make the BOC the lead determinant of the fair market value in concurrence with DA and DTI. For domestically produced commodities, we decided that the BOC would not take the lead, but rather the DTI. So we've already reflected here in our definition. For domestically produced commodities, fair market value refers to the suggested retail price as determined by the Department of Trade and Industry in concurrence with the Department of Agriculture of the agri-fishery commodities or tobacco at the time of the commission of the crime. So we're already clarifying here at the onset that for domestically produced commodities, the DTI would take the lead in determining the fair market value as based on the suggested retail price. And for imported commodities, it is determined by the Bureau of Customs based on the transaction value. Yes, go ahead, Mr. Chang.
Yes, Madam Chair, I'd just like to comment that the transaction value, as far as importers understand it, transaction value is the price that we pay to the exporter. That is the transaction value. It is not determined by customs or anybody else. Now, what is happening is that when we go into customs could change the value and it becomes a different value, becomes a declared value and entered value. But transaction value in import-export trade is the price that we pay to the exporter. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am?
I would first like to recognize the Honorable Horatio Swenson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. With regards to the transaction value, the definition is clearly defined under WTO. So, nirefer na natin yan sa customs kasi sila yung authority. So, may precise definition ang transaction value sa WTO. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Representative Swenson. Attorney Inchong?
Ma'am, just a note of concern on the transaction value. That's ang worry ko lang, it might tie down the authority or the Bureau of Customs with respect to questioning the transaction value, because the transaction value is not sacred even under the rules of the WTO. The WTO enumerates 6 methods for questioning the transaction value. Given the fact that there is pressure to produce revenue, we should not limit the authority or the powers recognized by the WTO or the customs authority to question the transaction value. Because in practice here, very much abuse yung transaction value in terms of undervaluation, etc. Yun lang, ma'am. It is up to the Bureau. Because my concern is a rather smart lawyer may construe this later on as I limit to the authority of the Bureau of Customs to use instruments allowed to them by the WTO.
Madam Chair, with regards to the concern of Attorney Chong, in relation to the provision of the WTO, we also have a provision on the CMTA regarding the valuation process on the transaction value. So covered na yun, Attorney Chong. Sorry. So, meron ng WTO definition, meron pa yan sa CMTA. So, na-safeguard na yan yung rights ng importer,
as well as the functions ng bureau. Kasi kung may problema yung transaction, yung transaction bolyo, pwede questionin ng customs. Ngayon may proseso na yan.
Madam Chair?
May I first recognize Ascom Maranilla to respond to that concern on the part of the BOC?
Well, as long as it's clear, Your Honor, anyway, we'll have, I'm pretty sure we'll have an opportunity to clarify this during the drafting of the implementing rules and regulations. Anyway, I would agree with, I note the concern of Attorney Bong Inchong, but also would like to recognize the point of Congressman Swansing. The transaction value rule is actually recognized in several laws, not just the CMTA, the Republic Act 9135, also which puts into local legislation our commitment with the WTO rules on valuation, also enumerates and enunciates the method of transaction value. I guess reading it as a lawyer, it can be interpreted in a lot of ways, but I think that can, the spirit of the law can still be clarified during the IRR stage. And tama naman po, wala naman pong masyadong, the word transaction value is already defined under several laws, and that can be used to clarify any misinterpretation in accordance with this provision.
Thank you very much, Ascom. Mr. Song, were you raising your hand a while ago? Would you like to be acknowledged? Mr. Kainlap.
Good morning. Idadagdag lang po dun sa definition section 3A, yung palm oil and palm olein. Kasi magkaiba yan eh. Marami kasing cases. I'm sure people from Bureau of Customs will know that. Na isa rin siyang...
So it's coconut oil,
palm oil, palm olive, yes, olive, palm olive. Olive.
Palm olive, yes. Okay, sige po. The broader we define this definition, the better, kasi po walang ligtas yung mga smugglers.
And we also like to flag, yung sa case ng fertilizers, hindi ko alam kung may papasok natin dito kasi problema rin ng industry yung naganap na pagpasok ng mga ano. Or kahit yung dito, yung manufacture ng fake fertilizers.
May I solicit the comment of the Department of Agriculture if we may also include fertilizers and pesticides? Because they are no longer raw, they are already processed goods.
Yes, Your Honor. Good morning, Your Honor. We are amenable to that proposition on the inclusion of fertilizer, Your Honor. Considering that the national the fertilizer agency is under the one of the FSRA of Department of Agriculture, Your Honor.
Fertilizer is the category of fertilizer is different from agri products. We're talking about here agricultural smuggling. So, siguro separate bill na lang yan. If Mr. Kenglit would like to draft a bill specifically addressing the problem on the fertilizer or pesticide, we can sponsor that for you, Mr. Kainlit. Pero huwag na natin i-water yung water down yung mobile na ito. Magulo na to. So, pag dinagdagan natin yan, hindi tayo matapos ngayong araw na to.
Madam Chair, hindi pwede naman na kung may kapangailangan, palakasin nyo to strengthen the regulatory power of the Fertilizer and Pesticide Authority. Pwede rin tingnan natin paano hahagupin yon. Andito naman ang chairman ng Committee on Agriculture and Food. Kung tanungin natin na FPA kung may pangangailangan palakasin yung regulatory power niya. Actually, nagtataka nga tayo kung bakit hindi ginagamit yung regulatory power doon sa pagtatakda ng retail and wholesale prices ng yung various grades ng fertilizers. Kaya umaakyat. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kapaeng. Would that suffice, Mr. Kainlap? Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, if there are no other comments on sections A to D, subsections A to D, we'll move to subsection E from the DTI.
On lines on section 3D po, ma'am, subject to the comments of the BOCDA and DTI. We wrote that in the draft it mentions in concurrence with do we have to agree on the price? Maybe we could maybe change this into in consultation with.
This the wording in concurrence with was actually suggested by the BOC, by ASCO Madanilia. In terms of the BOC in concurrence with the Department of Agriculture. So I would like to also refer that back to ASCO Madanilia.
So Madam Chair, we suggested that because there were during the previous hearing, there were several suggestions on establishing some sort of a system to have a check and balance on how the Bureau of Customs values it. And also, I would like to have recognition on the expertise of the Department of Agriculture to determine the kind, quality, and the actual values, no? Because most of the time, our reference values for agricultural products are established by the Department of Agriculture. That's why we propose that that the Department of Agriculture also concurs with. And anyway, the value that we will be coming up with here is not for assessment purposes, but it's more for establishing the threshold value for determining whether they will fall under the under economic sabotage or anti-agricultural smuggling. So that's why we're very open into having a joint exercise with the Department of Agriculture in terms of determining the value of the goods to determine the threshold price.
Thank you very much, ASCO Maranilia. If it's okay with Annette, we would prefer to keep the term in concurrence with. Thank you very much. Before we proceed, I would like to first acknowledge the author of House Bill number 3596 and the chairperson of the Committee on Ways and Means, the Honorable Representative Julie Salceda. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, for attending today's technical working group hearing. Okay. Any other comments from sections A to D? If not, we'll proceed with subsection E on the definition of tobacco. So this was the initial definition that was presented in House Bill number 3917, authored by Representatives Marcos and Nograles, already approved on third reading. But upon the suggestion of JTI during the first technical working group, and upon consulting with Representatives Marcos and Nograles, they agreed to modify the definition of tobacco as indicated in their third in their bill already approved in third reading. So based on the definition of JTI, the definition of tobacco which we'll adopt in the substitute bill is as follows. Tobacco refers to both manufactured and unmanufactured tobacco. Manufactured tobacco refers to any finished product that consists tobacco, such as cigarettes, cigars, heated tobacco products, or any product containing tobacco that is intended for smoking or heating or puffing or oral or nasal use. Unmanufactured tobacco refers to agricultural components derived from the tobacco plant, which are processed for use in the manufacturing of cigarettes and other tobacco products. I would like to open the floor to JTI to quickly explain the rationale behind the new definition.
Hi, I'm Bernie Paolo Patang of JTI. The reason why we had this amended from the previous version is because as originally worded, which included the phrase containing tobacco in products such as cigarettes, the issue there is it might be interpreted in such a way that when you talk about manufactured tobacco, it's just a part of the manufactured goods. Whereas it is our position that the finished goods of tobacco should be already included in itself in the scope of this bill, precisely because it falls under the definition of agricultural products under the rice tariffication law and also in the agreement of agriculture by the of the World Trade Organization. That's it, Joanna.
Thank you very much. It's, the group is in concurrence and is in agreement with this new definition. We will proceed. Thank you very much. I'll say, Jethro.
Good morning. I'm Jethro Sabriaga from the Bureau of Internal Revenue. We just have two comments on the definition, no? But it's not as substantial as it is. No, on the second paragraph on the definition of manufactured tobacco, it's just a matter of semantics. No, we could remove the ors in the definition. Specifically, containing tobacco that is intended for smoking or heating or puffing or oral or nasal use. So we can remove the ors, the multiple ors there. So that's it. For the third paragraph on unmanufactured tobacco, we would like to propose two things. One, we would like to amend the word processed. Unmanufactured tobacco refers to agricultural components derived from the tobacco plant, which are processed, we wish it to be, which are intended for use in the manufacture of cigarettes and other tobacco products. So two things, no? The verb, the description, instead of processed, we wanted it to be intended for use in the manufacture. And second, the verb manufacturing to manufacture.
As a Jethro, just to run down, the first is to remove or and or, so it would read as smoking, heating, puffing, oral or nasal use. Did I catch that correctly?
Yes,
And then the second is you would like unmanufactured tobacco to read as refers to agricultural components derived from the tobacco plant, which are intended for use in the manufacture of cigarettes and other tobacco products.
Yes, Your Honor. Okay. Other than that, we run our we run the entire bill and discussed it, and we find no other comments or manifestations on the bill.
Thank you very much, Asek. JTI, as the definition was suggested from your side, any comments on the suggestions of the BIR?
Madam Chair, we are amenable with their suggestions.
Okay. If the body is amenable to that, accepted, and that will be incorporated into the substitute bill. Thank you very much. Okay. The next, defining the acts that constitute cartelizing and other acts of market abuse. So this was the next slides and the new definitions are a product of the workshop that was conducted by the Committee on Agriculture and Food, the PCC and DTI. So cartelizing is now defined as follows. Cartelizing refers to any agreement between two or more entities which have object or effect of substantially preventing, restricting, or lessening competition as defined in Section 14 of RA 10667. Unprohibited cartel conduct as defined under Section 5.3 of RA 7581, provided that an agreement herein refers to any type or form of contract, arrangement, understanding, collective recommendation or concerted action, whether formal or informal, explicit or tacit, written or oral. Moreover, there shall be factual evidence of a cartel whenever A, there is parallel pricing, or B, there is any market behavior that tends to exclude the possibility of independent action by the entities involved. So the PCC manifested during our previous technical working group hearing that They would like to also include supply manipulation in the definition of cartelizing, because previously it only referred to acts that aim to influence price. So giving the workshops, this is the new definition of cartelizing. Mr. Song?
Question lang, no? Kasi pa yung mga nahuhuli na imported product nasa market na yun, no? Kunyari, nasa Metro Manila market. Yung transaction value ba, ibabase rin ba dun sa fair value or market value dun sa lugar?
Congressman Swenson, would you like to respond?
Ang question dyan, is it a smuggled item or not? Kung smuggled dyan, baliwala na yung transaction value. Outright smuggling will be forfeited in favor of the government. So, wala na yun ng transaction value.
Yung amount kasi yung threshold eh.
Wala na pag smuggled items, hindi na pinag-uusapan yung valuation process dyan, yung transaction value.
Ah, okay.
Papasok lang yung value kung i-auction na yan ng gobyerno. Pero sa agricultural products, lahat yan kinokondemn.
Kung yung ano po kasi, yung kailangan yung threshold sa amount para mag-qualify siya sa economic sabotage. Kaya kung nasa palengke halimbawa, ano ang gagamitin po na
imprisonment value? Sa imprisonment fines na yan. So, yun nga, na-define na yung transaction value in that case, yung Bureau of Customs na DEA and other attached agencies ang magdi-determine.
Yeah, in a case kasi, kunyari, yung meat na huli dun sa market of Manila, ang nangyayari kasi is i-re-repair ulit sa custom yung pag-seas noon eh. Pero yung mga stocks is binebenta as retail price. So, saan magpo-fall yun? Yung computation kasi ng filing ng case, ang DA, kunyari nag-file ng case, saan nila i-re-repair yung presyo? Dun sa transaction value or yung market value?
Pasok na eh siguro yung ano natin, definition natin. Baka sa market value na natin i-base yun.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I refer to Congressman Swenson being, you know, the former Deputy Commissioner for Enforcement of the Bureau of Customs. He would know best. So I would refer to his wisdom on this matter. Okay, so my apologies, I read the wrong second paragraph for subsection C. It should be this one. There shall be prima facie evidence of cartelizing whenever two or more entities competing for the same market and dealing in the same agricultural commodities or tobacco or business enterprises ancillary to the transaction perform uniform or complementary acts among themselves. I believe this is the same definition that we had during the previous technical working group. Before we move on, any comments on the definition of cartelizing? Okay. With the confirmation of the body, we'll proceed with the...
Madam Chair?
Yes, Representative Salceda.
It's an oxymoron if you define cartel and then use the word compete. If you're competing, then you're not a cartel.
PCC?
Your Honor, I think the intended word would be competitors, entities or competitors.
How is that, sir? How can somebody competing be carteling?
Yes, sir. Your Honor, I believe the language in the section is referring to the entities, sir.
Precisely. So we're probably serving, covering the same market.
Yes,
so
sir.
What if they don't compete? Let's say segment the market into, let's say, psychographic segmentation, and therefore they may be carteling, but they are not competing.
Yes, sir. Actually, that's one of the...
Since that, I think we have to have a more generic word. Operating in the same market, serving the same market, covering the same market. Because you say you compete, and then you're not a cartel.
Yes, Your Honor. I submit that is actually very... That is correct, sir. Yes, sir.
I also agree. Perhaps we can adopt operating in the same market.
Yes, Your Honor.
Representative Salceda, would that suffice? That's a very good observation. We'll amend the second paragraph to read: there shall be prima facie evidence of cartelizing whenever two or more entities operating for in the same market and dealing in the same agri-fisheries commodities or tobacco or business enterprises or transaction perform uniform or complementary acts among themselves. Let's see. There's also reference to competing in the last line. They simultaneously and unreasonably increase prices on their competing products, thereby lessening competition among themselves. I think this one, the last part is okay. But thank you very much, Representative Salceda. May you please raise your nameplate? My apologies, I'm unable to see it.
I'm from the
Ms. Manabat.
Madam Chair, in the same definition of prima facie evidence of cartelizing, the act being referred to is these two or more entities must perform uniform or complementary acts. And then it was further qualified when they simultaneously and unreasonably increase prices. So for me, that is two contradicting definitions because in a cartel, those two or more entities, there is a cartel when they agree to simultaneously increase the price, for example, next month. So we agree by September, by October 1, we will increase by 10%. But in the previous act, we can still be involved in cartel when we agree to perform uniform or complementary acts, meaning I will increase in the first 2 weeks and they will increase in the next 2 weeks. These acts, the increase is not simultaneous, but they are complementary. So if it is possible, I humbly suggest that the prima facie evidence of cartelizing is committed when these entities simultaneously and unreasonably increase prices or otherwise perform uniform or complementary acts which tend to bring about artificial and unreasonable increase in the price to cover not only simultaneous acts but all other acts which are in at first glance are not really possibly agreed upon but it may be committed subsequently or but still complementary. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Chair, can we bring back with your permission,
yes, Representative Salceda.
Yung sinasabi niya.
Pakibalik yung slides, please.
Page 5.
Slide 5. Page 6 na.
Page 6 na.
Ayan. Pwedeng concertedly.
Hindi naman, I think it will not kill it if we take away the word simultaneously. So let's just delete simultaneously and. So allowing for intertemporal actions in concert, that what's being penalized here is really the unreasonable high prices arising from certain acts, whether they are simultaneous, subsequent, or there is intertemporal act. So we are penalizing the act, but we're not defining exactly how they did it. But the third word there is, that's probably, it has to be there, in concert. The word is in concert. I don't know where to put the concert. But it's there already, perform uniform or complementary. Masyadong ano to si, kanino to galing sa akin? So entities perform, no, they don't have to perform uniform and complement. They have to perform acts in concert among themselves. So you don't have, it has, doesn't have to be uniform or complementary. It has to just to be in concert. Consider to the transaction, perform acts in concert among themselves, which tend to bring about artificial and unreasonable increase in the price of agriculture or tobacco when they unreasonably increase prices. Hindi kasi yung word na perform uniform is very difficult to prove. I tried to prove that already in the cement in 1999. Very difficult. I saw the, I presented the how do you call that? The minutes of the board of FINMA that they talked to another group of cement manufacturers, but it was trashed. So basically, so I think the word there is that there was unreasonable increase in price that arose from actions in concert among themselves. So yun na lang siguro. Kasi yung word na per uniform and complementary, very difficult to ano, very difficult to prove in court. I tried that already with the tariff commission. I don't know, I forgot. There was no PCC then. Anyway, it's up to you, Madam Chair. I think the law should be, ito kasi, implementable and enforceable. When you put words such as uniform, and therefore there's no variations of uniformity and complementarity, that's bigger actually in terms of how complementary they are. But the key issue there is unreasonably high prices and supposed competitors are acting in concert, whether together or whether one after another or something like that, Your Honor.
Thank you very much, Representative Sosad. I completely agree with that point, because a while ago there are two conditions that they need to satisfy. So we have to prove that the acts were performed, that the acts are uniform and complementary. And then second, we have to also, as pointed out by Ms. Manabat, we also have to prove that they simultaneously acted together. So in order to address that, we're adopting the suggestion of Representative Salceda to change it to perform acts in concert among themselves, which tend to bring about artificial and bring about artificial and unreasonable increase in the price of agricultural commodities or tobacco, which unreasonably increase prices on their competing products, thereby lessening competition among themselves.
Parang double, no?
Parang nga po eh. When I read it out, I feel like the previous line and the next line.
So, when they simultaneously unreasonably, yung acts na to. So, they are different actually, Madam Chair. Your unreasonable increase is the overall market price. The individual acts are increased prices on their own. So I think it could stand. So tama na yun, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Representative Salceda. I also agree. When I read it now again, the first one talks about the the overall, and then the second one refers specifically to the individual act. Sorry, please read the nameplates. Yes, Mr. Tenglet. Because I think, sorry. Attorney Ong. Yes, my apologies, my eyes are failing me today. First, Mr. Tenglet, and then next, Attorney Ong.
Similar sa concerns ni Mrs. Nipong Salceda. Yung letter C cartelizing refers to any agreement between. Ang multiple na agreement, baka pwedeng any action or any acts. Kasi pag sinabing refers to any agreement, mas mahirap mahuli kung any agreement. Baka pwedeng acts or actions or undertaking. Kasi pag agreement, explicit dapat mahirap. So,
may TOJ ba? Given that they will be the ones prosecuting the cases and filing the cases, may I solicit the wisdom of the OSG and the DOJ on this query?
Madam Chair, if I may be allowed. Cartel is a term used in the antitrust law in the United States. So cartel is a technical term wherein two or more persons come together and meet and come to an agreement. But when you look into the European competition law, the European Commission avoids using the word cartel and instead use agreement. Because in fact, even in our PCA, the Philippine Competition Act, Section 14 encompasses the word cartel, anti-competitive agreement, and not cartel. Because cartel is a limited technical term. But when you look at Section 14 of the PCA, it penalizes anti-competitive agreement. It covers a formal agreement, or when two or more of us meet here, for example, we have a convention, we are all producers of a certain commodity, and on the side, we agree that by next month, we will limit our supply by 10%, or we increase our price by 10%. There is already an agreement there. It is not required to be in writing as long as one of us consent, two or more of us consent to commit an anti-competitive act covered by the PCA. So I agree with the proposed definition of cartelizing that it is comprehensive enough to refer to any agreement, because the term agreement is more broad than than referring to an action, because an action, pag sinabi niyo po kasi action, meaning it requires a conduct. But in cartelizing, even if the mere consent is already penalized, you don't need to do that. For example, three of us are suppliers. On September 6, we agree to limit price by October 6. Even if we do not actually increase price by October, the law already penalizes us because we agree to commit the increase in price. But if you use cartelizing to an action, if I am the one to be accused, I will say that, yes, we agreed, but I didn't actually increase it by October. So it is evasive of the law. But when you use agreement, the mere consent to commit an act by increasing price or limiting supply, which tend to increase price, you're already penalized. Thank you.
Madam Chair, I would first like to go to Attorney Ong from the DOJ. I think what we really want, and I think the whole body agrees with the same, we want to make it easy to convict particular individuals. So we want to prosecute them. Kailangan on the part of OSG and DOJ, that's why I ask you, kasi kayo talaga yung magpa-process ng mga kaso. Kaya, Attorney Ong from the DOJ.
Hi, good morning everyone from the National Prosecution Service. Number one, the world agreement is already broad enough. In fact, if we look at the last part of the sentence po, there is already the word concerted action. This is, shall we say, parang catch-all na to, sir. Whether it's a consent, direct or indirect, acquiescence, tolerance. When we file cases in court, it's not necessarily a direct evidence, ma'am. We also call those things mga surrounding circumstances whereby we can prove that an individual in fact participated directly or indirectly through their concerted actions. Conspiracy can be proved through other things rather than just the direct operative act, ma'am. So for us, agreement is broad enough to cover actions and tolerance or indirect participation. Thank you, po, Your Honor.
Thank you, Attorney Ong. I feel like all the lawyers in this room are raising their hands. Attorney Chong.
Nung magpapakulong tayo ng tao dito, we need clarity on ano yung prima facie evidence dito na sinasabi. Normally, when you say prima facie, it's obvious, self-evident. It's something that has to be controverted. Normally, no, akusado. Under the way it is worded, by analogy, ibig mong sabihin, ma'am, pagka itong mga gasoline oil company, sabay-sabay nagtaas, prima facie evidence yun. And ibig mong sabihin, pagka yung mga importer o yung mga magmamanok, magmamapoy, sabay-sabay nagtaas because of market conditions, prima facie yun. Magpapakulong tayo dito ng tamang, kaya kailangan mag-ingat lang tayo, ma'am. Ako, okay lang sama. Ako lang yung ibang, yung mga smuggler. Kanya lang. Kanya lang, ma'am. We're going to incarcerate people here. We need to be, what is the obvious evidence na hindi na kailangan? Kasi when you say prima facie, lilipat yung ano, I mean, you did something, you have to explain it. Yung akusado mag-i-explain kasi may prima facie evidence.
Representative Salcedo, before we go to the OSG to respond.
Hindi naman ganun ka delusional yung definition.
I agree.
Sinasabi naman dito artificial. It can be proven. Unreasonable. It can be proven. Individual acts of raising prices can be proven. And the overall increase in market prices can be proven, can be documented. So we will not be jailing any Tom, Dick, and Harry. It's just the way it was worded. Now it seems like, you know, it's very difficult to implement. In fact, if you read the whole from the word cartelizing up to the end of the word, which is among themselves, you can virtually say na possibly yung word agreement. Sometimes, I don't know, yung mga tinawag mo na who has a legal definition of agreement?
DOJ, OSG?
Madam Chair, if my memory serves me right, I have not come across a legal provision wherein the word agreement is defined. But what is included is, for example, a contract or a consent. That's why in the law, in the PCA, I understand that when the PCA was enacted, the Congress did not use the word contract or consent, but rather agreement, because it is an unacceptable word that this exhaustive and broad to cover not only a written one in the form of a contract, but also a verbal or any arrangement as provided for in the proposed definition of titleizing in C.
I think there's no more debate.
Yes, I agree. I think as long as the DOJ and the OSG say that they can actually lodge the cases with this definition, and we will be able to convict people based on this definition, because I mean, based on the information shared by DPI previously, there's actually very little cases that they're able to lodge on even the other terms, yung profiteering based on price tag lang. Yung mga ganun. So what we want is to make sure that the definition is permissive enough such that we'll actually be able to conduct people. So yeah. Any other comments on this definition? Attorney Ong.
For the second paragraph, last sentence, ma'am. We just want to have it mirrored with the Tax Act, ma'am. So, and unreasonable increase in the price of agricultural commodities or tobacco, ma'am, we propose to incorporate comma, and then all when they simultaneously an unreasonable increase. Kasi dalawang mode po yung sa Tax Act. This is the second mode.
Yes. Although, attorney, we've already changed that based on the suggestion of Representative Salcedo. So we've taken out simultaneously. So we it already now reads as but artificial and unreasonable increase in the price of agricultural commodities or tobacco, which unreasonably increased price.
I'm going to propose to incorporate the word all. Two modes, eh. Ma'am, it's two modes po kasi sa Price Act, Your Honor.
Pero wala na yung tema sa Price Act. Wala na yung word.
Nakakaduling na kasi.
Wala na po yung word na simultaneously. We've already taken that out.
Your Honor, okay lang po yung word na simultaneously. What we wanted to have is the word or po. Or, when doing, ma'am. Para to have it on a two modes for complaints.
But we've removed simultaneously. So would you would like to return the word simultaneously?
The word or.
Where would you like to put on?
Tobacco or when they.
Wala na po kasi yung word na paglalagyan natin ng or. Kaya po nalilito ako.
Opo.
Wala na yung phrase na yon.
Increase in the price of agricultural commodities or tobacco
50%
or ma'am or when they unreasonably increase prices or ma'am.
Okay, so hindi na siya magiging preceding action.
Yes, ma'am.
Sequential yung
magiging two modes na yung ano.
Okay. Sige. Noted. So kasi kanina the way we worded it, that is the result, di ba? Which unreasonably increased price. But what you're saying is you want it to be another action.
That's
what I'm going to read as which tend to bring about artificial and unreasonable increase in the price of agricultural commodities or tobacco or when they unreasonably increase prices on their competing products.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. If that makes it broader, if that allows us to file cases in a protest still, I'm okay with that. Pero pag or, paano, kasi consequence niya dapat yung which unreasonably increased price eh. That's my concern for including
okay.
Or.
Okay naman siya, di ba?
Mm-hmm.
Or when they unreasonably increase prices.
Yeah.
So that's, I think that's the new one. Let me see that.
Yes, that's correct. Mr. Chair, that's correct po.
Yun, asan yung or?
Tobacco.
Yung pula.
Or when they unreasonably increase price.
Is that an or?
Opo. Or when they.
After tobacco or.
Opo.
Right. That's it.
And then comma before that. Is that, are we gonna place a comma? Lawyers. Nagagalit yung mga abogado sa akin kasi ang dami ko daw maglagay ng comma. Nahihirapan daw po silang mag-imaneobra sa korte yung mga binag-draft.
Madam Chair.
Yes,
malinaw na yung ganong malinaw. Hindi mabigat yung requisites to prove yung cause of action. Kasi alam naman natin, there is no crime and there is no law defining and penalizing a crime, a certain crime. Hanggat magaan din i-prove yung beyond reasonable doubt. Diba? So, basta klaro sa batas. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay. Last on Representative Sasada, Ariel, naka-on po kasi yung mic. OSG?
Yes, Madam Chair. Ma'am, I understand Attorney Ong's suggestion because we also agree to that suggestion. From my understanding, Madam Chair, the prima facie evidence may be proved on two modes. One is when these two or more entities unreasonably increase price, which is a direct act. They agree to unreasonably increase price. And then the second mode is, as suggested by Congressman Salceda, these two or more entities perform any other acts in concert which tend to bring about. So the first act, as suggested by Attorney Ong, is a direct action, a direct agreement to unreasonably increase the price. And then the one suggested by Congressman Salceda will cover all other acts in concert which has a tendency to bring about the artificial and unreasonable increase in the price, which is also the same definition covered by Section 14 of the PCA. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Ms. Manabat. We all agree with that, but the new definition allows two modes for filing the cases. So I think we're all in agreement on the definition of cartelizing. This is new, so I think that's the reason why this is actually soliciting the vote. Okay, so next, this is another new definition.
Other acts.
Other acts of market abuse. This was suggested during the last technical working group hearing that we also need to include the definition for other acts of market abuse. So this wording was suggested by the PCC and is broad enough to cover acts not defined as hoarding, profiteering, or cartelizing. So catch all siya kung ano man po yung hindi natin makapture doon sa ibang mga definitions. It reads as, other acts of market abuse refers to one or more entities who abuse their dominant position by engaging in conduct that would substantially prevent, restrict, or lessen competition, such as but not limited to the acts referred to under Section 15 of the PCA, and engaging in any of the prohibited, deceptive, unfair, or unconscionable sales acts or practices covered by the Consumer Act of the Philippines.
Yes,
Representative Sasada.
Para naman there is guidance on what exactly this means, although it was not proffered, I did not proffer this. Halimbawa, ako ang nasa Pulanggi. Lahat ng fertilizer dumadaan sa akin. Tapos, dahil sa akin dumadaan, ako lang nagko-control ng merkado, lahat ng farmer sa akin bibili, and therefore, because ako ang may control the market, I can abuse the market by saying, okay, you sell it to me at 50, I'll sell it at 60. Simply because by such an act, because you have abuse of market power. So ito yung catch-all na sinasabi dito. Hindi, it's not some how do you call that, some heavenly idea. It's an idea that happens every day. Because there is the Philippines, one country where 85% where the index for business concentration is so high, and therefore abuse of market power. Although abuse of market is good enough, you don't have to prove power; you can only prove abuse of the market. So I think that's good enough. Not putting abuse of market power. The tendency of PCC is always to include abuse of market power. So in short, there are. This is not it will be very useful for future litigation actually. So I congratulate Madam Chair for the inclusion of this letter.
Thank you very much, Representative Saseda. That's I think the key term here, as well as the dominant position. So it's easier to actually prove that player. I mean, if they have the biggest market share. Or they're the only player in the market, it's very easy to actually prove that.
Yung isang ano niyan is Microsoft, you can ease out all other OS by ensuring that all the machines they sell have their own OS. So that is probably the proof of the abuse of market power, which is will be included under this letter D.
Thank you very much, Representative Salceda. Also, I would also like to recognize the PCC for also suggesting the ruling for the other acts of market abuse. Okay, so I think we're okay with the definition. Okay. Lots of comments from the body. First OSG, and then Attorney Chong, and then JTI.
Yes, Madam Chair. Ma'am, for clarification, in this definition of other acts, we are the broad definition is these entities abuse their dominant position. And then when you refer to Section 15, but not limited to, it is because Section 15 is essentially abuse of dominant position, which is already covered by the PCA. But we use semicolon. So it indicates a different act. So other market abuse can be committed either one, the entities abuse their dominant position by engaging in conduct to substantially prevent, restrict, or lessen competition, including but not limited Section 15, or when those entities engage in any of the prohibited, deceptive, unfair, unconscionable sales act or practices, which is called by another law, the Consumer Act. So I would just like to be clarified whether the use of semicolon after the PCA indicates a different mode of being convicted of committing other acts of market abuse. Thank you.
May I refer this question to the PCC?
Thank you, Madam Chair. The intention really for the letter B or other acts of market abuse is to make it a little bit broader. So not just Section 15 of the PCA, but such other schemes or inventiveness of market participants that we might not be able to envision or imagine now. If they fall under this, at least the intention, we would have the leeway to go after them. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
OSG, is that a sufficient response?
Ma'am, from what the PCC explained, it would appear that the other market act, other acts of market abuse would require that the entities must be in their dominant position and they abuse their dominant position, right, Attorney Tawit? That's the first condition. The entities must have a dominant position in the relevant market, and second, they must abuse their dominant position. And then this abuse of dominant position would cover not only Section 15, but also any acts under 7394. So my question would be, under RA 7394, entities that commit prohibited, deceptive, unfair, or unconscionable sales act would require the second element of abuse of dominant position. Is that what you're saying?
My appreciation of this one is, my understanding is it should be in concert, because if you're a small player and you engage in these kinds of acts, there's a good chance it's not going to affect the market as much. So we just want to make sure that it's a broader catch-all provision for market abuses. But of course, subject to the wisdom of the committee and inputs from your good office.
Thank you, Attorney Sarah.
I apologize for answering directly. I should have asked permission first.
With that, Madam Chair, I agree with Attorney Sawit. I just like to comment that maybe we remove the semicolon and use instead of a semicolon. Thank you.
Ma'am, I respectfully submit. As to the semicolon.
You want would you like to have an or instead of a semicolon? Is GMA getting that right?
Yes, Madam Chair, because as explained by Attorney Sawit, the reference to Section 15 and RA 7394 are examples of those who abuse a dominant position. So it should be not limited to acts referred to under Section 15 or any of the prohibited, deceptive, unfair practices covered by Title 3, Chapter 1, RA 7394. Just semantics, Madam Chair.
With the permission of the body, we'd like to skip to we'll come back to that. We'll skip to the council and the task force because some of the members have to leave, and that's one of the main sources of contention. I understand I understand that this is, the definitions are contentious, but we'll skip to the council and the task force for now and return to these later.
Yung sa PowerPoint.
Chair, kasi we really need your take on this as well. So you want to skip to this before I talk.
Madam Chair, I apologize. I do not want to disrupt the flow of the discussion and the, of course, the amendments proposed by our resource persons. But if you will allow, I'll just leave it with the body. My apologies. I will have to attend to another meeting.
Sure.
Anyway, I want to pose this question because if there is hoarding, kung may mga hoarding, local produce ang laman, and they're in a warehouse, walang visitorial powers ang DA. Hindi papasukin. DTI, I don't think, wala rin yatang authority to go in these warehouses. So, in my purview, mukhang you will need a warrant for you to enter the premises of a local warehouse. So, if it would suffice na we include DILG, kasi yung local government ang may authority if it's in a locality. But, of course, I would want to get the opinion of the resource persons with us today. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you,
Mr. Chair. So very quickly, we'll just run through the proposal of this representation with regard to the structure of the council and the task force and the our proposal with regard to the composition of the council and the task force. And then we can, Chair, we can dive on that. Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Chair. But Mr. Chair, the concern is that the agencies do not have the power to go and do the raids themselves. So they would need a warrant. So we need someone within the task force to actually be able to issue warrants very quickly. So we'll take that into consideration when we discuss the composition of the task.
Thank you, Madam Chair. But of course, baka kasi the local government unit has the authority to visit at any time. Of course, using the sanitation and all, di ba? The guise of sanitation, di ba? Or declaration of what should be inside the warehouses. So thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. So I'll report to you, Chair. For you to discuss. Thank you very much. Okay, so this is the proposed structure. So essentially, the idea is to have a strong, independent, I wouldn't say independent, but very strong task force who can operate without the very strong supervision of a council. So that's why later when we show the proposed composition of the task force, strong na siya in itself, but we have the council to actually oversee and give the guidance for the task force. So our proposal in terms of the structure would be to have a council and then a task force, and then you have a congressional oversight committee that would do evaluations on the council and the task force and the overall implementation of the law. First is this, which is the, let me just skip to that. We call it the Anti-Agri-Fishery Commodities and Tobacco Economic Sabotage Council. So there is hereby established a council to be led by the Office of the President and to be composed of the following. First, a representative from the Office of the President or the President's duly appointed representative. And then we have permanent representatives from the different government agencies. So a permanent representative from the DOF, DILG, DOJ, and the PCC. In our suggestion, to have private sector representation, three representatives from the private sector with fixed terms of 3 years, and then the private sector can elect to have a different representative to the council. The permanent representatives shall be appointed by the heads of the agencies. And then before we solicit the comments, we'd first like to explain the powers and functions of the council. First is to essentially give the policy guidance. So to prepare appropriate and effective measures to prevent violations, to oversee the conduct of the task force, to cause or direct the immediate investigation and recommend the initiation of cases. And more importantly, to monitor the progress of such cases to ensure higher conviction rates, to perform such functions and carry out such activities as may be directed by the president. I will also suggest that the council meet quarterly, and the council shall convene the task force within 60 days from the approval of this act to ensure a timely action on this matter. Moreover, the council shall determine the continued operations or the dissolution of the task force, or whichever way they feel it needs to be modified for it to be more effective. And then on the part of the task force, we are suggesting for it to be led by the Department of Agriculture. We can discuss that later. And then in terms of the composition, this would all be comprised of government agencies, given the police powers of the task force. So we suggest to have permanent representatives from DA, DOC, DTI, NBI, UNP, and the Coast Guard. In terms of the powers and functions of the task force, we suggest for them to effect searches, seizures, and arrests, to inspect warehouses where seized commodities are stored, to conduct intelligence and counterintelligence activities, which includes monitoring of situations, to secure copies of documents pertaining to the nature, in particular subject to the importation. And similarly, the task force shall be mandated to report to the council every quarter. I would, before we proceed, I would like to recognize Representative Gustam Bunting. Thank you very much, Mr. Chen.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning to everyone.
Good morning. Good morning, Pa. Thank you very much for attending today's technical working group. Okay, and then magkakadugtong po kasi lahat to. So we'll first go through the council, the task force, and the oversight committee before we solicit the opinions of the group. And then we also propose the creation of a congressional oversight committee within 6 months from the passage of this act and every Congress thereafter. I believe this needs to be time bound to ensure that the oversight committee is convened. A mandatory.
Where's the creation of the congressional oversight committee? Where's the creation? Creation.
Actually, a congressional oversight committee that would be tasked to perform a review of the implementation of the act, also including the effectivity of the task force and the council, similar to how it is in terms of the RCEF under the RTL. There's a congressional oversight committee tasked to perform an evaluation of RCEF. So that's the model that we're thinking of adopting for this. So that's the overall structure that we're suggesting for the council, the task force, and the congressional oversight committee. So I would open the floor to the body for comments and suggestions.
Madam Chair.
Representative Briones.
Thank you for including the council in our bill, substitute bill. I agree with the government representative, like for example, Office of the President, Permanent Department of Finance, Department of Agriculture, DTI, DILG, DOG, and PCC. But for the representative from the private sector, I think we need to increase the number of representatives with regards to the agriculture sector, considering that agriculture sector is more or less 85% of the entire agri industry. If you give one representative from the tobacco sector, I think we need more representative from the agriculture sector. I suggest that we have one from rice and corn, livestock and poultry, vegetable, fruits and coconut, fisheries and other aquatic products. No. Sugar. So, rice and corn, livestock and poultry, vegetable, fruits and coconut, and sugar.
Representative Briotis, just to check, so you would like to increase the representation for the agricultural sector from 1 to 4?
Four.
Any other comments from the body? Please raise your name plate, sir. Mr. Fausto.
Yeah, thank you. In addition to what Kong Dicky said, I'd like to just inform the body that the RCEP ratification of the Senate has identified the participation of the private sector and identified the Committee on International Trade of the Philippine Council and Agriculture, the PICAP, which is the representative of the private sector of the DA.
Inaya ko na lang rin sa
We'll have a few minutes suspension.
Yan, bali kasi may mga national association ng sugar, rice, and
so on. Ano importante dito? Kasi yung vegetable and fruits,
yeah,
and masyado yun.
Itong coconut kasi sa palm oil.
Ganito magiging ano, toto.
Hindi, ngayon patuloy, no? Hindi, para mabilis tayo. So, may fisheries tayo.
Meron tayo dito ng fisheries tobacco.
Tobacco.
May rice and corn. Rice and corn, napakalaki niya.
So,
livestock and poultry, sobrang laki rin sa sector.
So, parang isa ito.
Iba-iba kasing association niya.
Ano oras ko sinabi ko?
Kami na. Hindi ano ko.
Kasa na yun.
Hindi mo na kaya ng pay. Pero bigyan mo pa rin yung lunch.
Ito na to, covered everything.
Alin
siya? Covered.
Covered everything.
Ano mo na yung para may tayo na mga ilo.
The meeting is resumed. Yes, Representative Sasada.
When I was still with President Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo, there was an Executive Order 297, March 10, 2004, creating the Office of the Anti-Smuggling Presidential Advisor. And Angie Reyes, after the DND, was appointed to this. So there is ample precedence, and therefore making it a law essentially strengthens, because even if we had this, and it's an EO, smuggling did not disappear. In fact, it accelerated. So I think there is benefit to creating such a council with an office of a, I don't know whether we can create a presidential advisor on, uy, buhay ka pa pala. Ay. Magkasasama kay John Ford sa. So essentially, I think it's very good that such an idea has been incorporated. Pero yung mga members dito, madam, essentially, the advisor, the DOF, the ILG, DND, Justice, Agri, DTI, Transport, and the exclusion of the representative of the affected sectors. I think both the private firms and farmers, I think, should be considered. It couldn't be na puro lang mga negosyante ang nandito sa loob ng council. So I do agree that we can be very expansive. So at the same time, so yung head definitely has to be an appointee of the president.
Thank you very much, Representative Sanzada. What we're doing, we're looking at the executive order for PASG. So we're looking at the structure. And as you mentioned, it's called Anti-Smuggling Presidential Advisor. Yung chairman.
It's very good na kasi we're legislating it. But anyway, smuggling seems to be here perpetually. So we need a perpetual institution to go against it. So anyway, so kung ang problema lang in terms of, I think I will leave it, I think, to the chair to just include anyone for as long as they're amply represented, like both farmers. Siyempre, ang ano lang dito is, so yung the way it's being represented now, okay naman siya eh. Wala namang, there's nothing egregious about it except that the absence of farmers' representatives, basically.
Mm-hmm.
You need to put them. But the president will appoint. Sorry, KMP will never be. Will never be appointed. The other problem I have with that, Madam Chair, is of course is the secretariat. So you have a council that makes policy, but then you have a head, which is a presidential advisor, quasi-secretary, near secretary or whatever. And then you need a secretariat to help him. You can appoint DA to be the secretariat or the BOC.
I think the BOC can provide. Ilan ba tao mo? Jet, ilan ba tao nyo na hindi naman nagtatrabaho?
Madam Chair, we're about, right now, we're about 2,000.
Oh, kaya naman po next month. So, kasi 2,000 lang kayo.
We're overall plantilla position, you know, is supposed to be about 6,000. I'm sorry, 4,000 na pala kayo, sir, because of the hiring. But we're still short by about 2,000 plantilla personnel.
Okay, Madam Chair. Siyempre, mas malakas ang tatay kaysa akin. Hindi, okay lang. So, okay na yun. May maganda na tayo. We're able to form. And I think basically, we need a secretariat for it.
Actually, Council said, we're actually discussing your proposal. So, we're looking at PASG and whichever we're in the panel, we're not yet included.
Because I cannot stay forever. And then the task force. So, kasi ang pinaka-heavily, my own estimate, I don't know whether Jet will agree with me, the total agri sector of the Philippines is about 2 trillion. But the imported GBA is 2.4. So you can just imagine that actually much of our consumption in agriculture is basically imported already. So you can just imagine the size and the magnitude of the potential for smuggling. So ang sinasabi lang dito, ang proposal ko na, kasi I have to go, insert in any of the other provision that the Secretary of Agriculture or the task force or such officers as you may be deputized may under reasonable grounds exercise the power to visit, inspect, or enter any place of business, factory, building, store, or vessel. Vessel containing or believed to contain agricultural products suspected of being hoarded or cartelized. The exercise of such power shall be through a mission order which shall clearly indicate to obviously the creation of PASG. Through a mission order which clearly indicate the grounds for such an order, the specific names of officers carrying out the mission and the tasks to be carried out in the mission. Any person deputized by the Secretary of Agriculture or the PASG, in this case, shall disclose the nature of the authority upon being questioned at the time of exercise thereof and shall exhibit the corresponding written. I will just give you the copy of, para magkaroon ng visitorial powers po ang, kasi useless din naman, hindi naman makakapasok kung wala yung, lalo-lalo na kung nasa loob na ng PESA, venue, nung hoarding, nung cartel, o nung smuggling. Kasi we're dealing with the three devils of agriculture, hoarding, cartel, and smuggling. So basically, I'm very happy with the way it's turning out, it's evolving, that there is essentially a PASG. Hopefully, you can create a secretariat for it. And hopefully, that there will be a task force and an oversight committee para it is a complete. It's just the way our economy has turned out to be, that imported agriculture in fact may be bigger than domestic agriculture precisely because of the way we plant our land use, because we don't have a land use plan. So anyway, I would like to thank and congratulate the TWD chairperson and just consider my inputs in further discussion. Just don't forget the farmers, but exclude Cain.
Point of privilege, I want to speak before he leaves, but the only people in this room who didn't see me, may I speak before he leaves?
Apologies, Karen, is it okay if I first respond to Representative Saseda before I recognize you? I will. I'll just say a few words.
The only people in the whole country who are here is the two of us. We know something. I've got to speak before he leaves.
Karen, I say something first to Representative Saseda. To your point about the visitation powers, very well noted, though, because that was also the point of Chair Mark and Berga, that the implementing agencies right now, as they are, do not have visitation powers. So we'll make sure that the task force will have visitation powers so that they can do the raids We're just trying to figure out the dynamics of it, whether we need to engage the individual LGUs or whether it should come from or emanate. We'll try to figure out where that power would emanate and who we need to have in the task force for them to have that power.
As an example, when I was governor, we were deputized by DTI for price monitoring, the governor of Albay. So the entire provincial government of Albay was deputized by the DTI to monitor prices. Kasi lagi may bagyo. Anyway, these things are actually, it's just that it's not being coded.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Representative Sazada. Ka Ernie, I would like to recognize you so that you may address Representative Sazada.
Because when he leaves, I want to leave because this guy is the most important guy in my life right now. Okay, the only people in this room who were present in that fight where we brought down smuggling by 25%, as recorded, not by communists, my friends are the communists, but by the United Nations, okay? Okay, he and I were together with Angie Reyes, right? And they abolished it, are the only one. And the only one, I'm not yet in heaven, I'm here. The only one in the entire Philippines who was in both forces is me. So I'd like to say this because, Corso Salcedo, you know how much I admire you. I'm perpetually for you, except sometimes. One of those sometimes is now. Now. I'll tell you why I disagree. You are so powerful, influential. I like to say this. Actually, you said that it could be customs. I object strongly. I mean, firstly, to be fair, you said Qatar or someone else. Sir, if you make it customs, I want to walk out with you. Because if it's customs, you can forget it. Later on, I can testify. Just going to tell Constantine that. Constantine said that I believe in you 99% of the time. I don't agree with you that it could be customs. Because that's precisely what happened. Just soundbite, sir. There are 3 cases by smugglers against me for harassing them. I had a deal with the assistant secretary to give away. They killed him 3 days later. Okay, I am deep in this. And Salceda, I'm deeply loyal to you, except maybe for that point. Thank you.
I received my comment.
Thank you very much. I would like to recognize Representative Briones.
Yeah, yung secretariat, maybe from the Department of Agriculture, not from the custom. I agree with you.
I'll check with the DA on that. If you have any objections, if not, we'll put you as a secretariat for the council. With regards to the composition of the council, Representative Briones.
Yeah. 3 from the private agricultural sector, 1 from the sugar industry, another one for rice and corn, and another one for livestock and poultry. So we have 3. And vegetable and fruits will be included in the rice and corn.
Rice and corn, vegetable. Fisheries.
Hiwala
yung fishery.
Hiwala yung fishery.
May sariling representative.
So, we have a representative from the fishery sector and from the tobacco sector.
Just to recap, so we'll have 3 representatives from the agricultural sector, 1 from sugar, 1 from rice, corn, vegetable, and fruits, 1 from livestock and poultry, 1 from fisheries, and 1 from tobacco. So we have 5 private sector representatives. Shall we retain with a fixed term of 3 years for the members of the private sector? So there's more dynamism in the representation for the private sector.
At least the sector will submit 3 nominees to the office of the president. President, and then the president will choose.
3 nominees for each of the 5 seats.
Yeah.
Okay. Noted. So the decision as to who will be members of the council will sit with the president.
Right.
The nominations will come from the sector. And then the president will select.
Yeah.
Okay.
Congressman Sun Sing.
Also, relative to the composition of the council, may I add, based on the organization of PASG, the representative from the National Defense and the representative from the DOTR, Transportation and Communications.
Thank you, Representative Spansing. But we'd also like to ask, because right now in our version, it's worded as Office of the President or the President's really appointed representative. However, when we looked at the structure of the PASG, it's explicitly said that it's a presidential advisor. Should we adopt the wording for the chairman of the PASG, or should we retain it as generic as it is right now, wherein it's OP or his really appointed representative? What would the body like to codify as law? Should we call it a presidential advisor or office of the president or the president's duly appointed representative? Safer po this way, no? We'll keep it the way that we worded it. Okay, so just to recap, we'll have 9 members from the government, 5 from private sector, led by the Office of the President or his duly appointed representative. On the part of the agencies, we have a permanent representative from the DOF, DA, DTI, DILG, DOJ, CC, Department of National Defense, and Department of Transportation. So DND and DOTR were part of PASV, so we're also lifting that to include that in our composition. On the part of the private sector, we have 5 members, representative from sugar, 1 from rice, corn, vegetable, and fruits, 1 from livestock and poultry, 1 from fisheries, and 1 from tobacco. So the private sector representatives will have a fixed term of 3 years. In terms of the nomination, in terms of how they will be elected to the council, each of the sectors will give 3 nominees, and then the president will select which of the nominees will become part of the council that will occupy the 5 seats for the private sector. Another comment, so I'll also open the floor to Mr. Danny Fausto. He has a manifestation about the PICAP.
Yes, but I think I concur already with the suggestion of Congressman.
Okay, so. Okay, all right, so Mr. Udones, Kat Rini.
Yes, I have been with 2 committees composed of 7 people each. Committees were abolished when we were succeeding catching the people. And this is relevant to your point. How big will these people be and who will be there? Okay. Maybe you can have a big one, but from experience, right? Okay. The first one was in Gloria. We were abolished because we caught big fish. The second one was in Pinoy. We were abolished because Duterte abolished us. But it is a small group that meets every month with customs, not 25 people. And it's very in-depth, right? Now, the secretariat must not be customs, because customs will control the information. Ridiculous. So, Mr. Seda, you're brilliant, but in that point, it is not a bit wise, all right? Because I'm talking from experience. Maybe you people, I'm deep in there, right? Okay, so let me say 2 points. Point number 1, Madam Chair. Please look at what succeeded. Instead of reinventing the wheel, look at the 2 that succeeded. I am the only one in the entire Philippines, and not yet dead, that was in present. And I saw the government abolish it when we're catching too many people, right? Okay? Okay. Number 1, look at it. So if you want 1,000 people in the community, it's okay. But you must have a group of about 6 or 7. Number 2, I see all these communities. Madam Chair, I want to let you know, no? I'm 2/3 private sector. I headed cement in 6 countries. But my heart is in agriculture. And I'm telling you, I was an undersecretary, offered 2 departments, and I took flagship with Ramos, so the head of all the groups, right? And I'm informing you, ma'am, that if you have 1,000 people or 25, whatever, fine. But you must have a small group of 6 or 7. That means customs, right? Because Senator Soto and Senator Lacson give speeches and nothing happens because they're legislative. They cannot fire those people. In that committee, we were able to get them. They were scared, right? Everyone, they'd come. Okay. And after we abolished it, it doubled. What does that mean? When you take out the private sector, the damn thing goes crazy. Now, if you have a big committee, very big, it's okay. But God forbid that's the one you're going to use, because you have a big people, nothing will happen. And if President Secretary, talaga nothing will happen. So, yun lang, and point ko lang po ay ganito, no? Look at what worked and see that, right? Okay. If you're going to have a big one, fine. But make sure you have a small group that meets every month the records of the president, right? So, I'd like to say I'm very grateful you called me. I want to work some more. I won't take the time. All these gentlemen are my friends, right? Some are my enemies, because just to entertain you, there are three cases by smugglers against me. One of them, the customs people were having affidavits to defend me. Their boss told them to withdraw the affidavits. They want me to fly. In other words, I'm loved by some, but not by others, right? So I'd like to say that. I would like to talk to you maybe in depth, but I'm telling you, I know exactly what happens, right? So thank you very much. I love Rosendo so. I love Paying Mariano. Incidentally, I love KMP, no? Then I don't agree with violence. Huh? Okay. Okay. Yeah. Yan ang po. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Karen. I think what I got as well is that that's also the reason why we were trying to streamline the composition of the council. That's why you wanted it to be more crisp. That's why I suggested whether we can actually like streamline it because we want a more dynamic council. Because one cautionary tale that was mentioned was the council that was developed for Coconut. And what happened is you have like a big council with 15 government agencies, but there was no designated lead. So walang movement. So that's why we wanted it to be really targeted in the way we're composing the council. We have a clear lead and then we have private sector involvement. So all of the points that you mentioned are also captured in the way we're structuring the council.
1 minute, I will forever be quiet, like I'm dead, right? But now I'll talk to you, right? Who are the six? The agriculture, I need all of them. Pero pagkansa kami, hindi naman lang po, sampu kami doon, ako lang, you know what I mean? In other words, who are the six? Let me name them. As I said, look at the composition. Incidentally, I was vice chair of the second one. Who are they? Who are they? Okay? DA, ito lang smuggling. DTI, yun ang tutulong sa smuggling minsan, yeah? Justice to get those bastards in jail, right? The ILG, because they're the force police and all that, right? Okay. And of course, finance, because they're supposed to look at smuggling. I'm telling you, they don't. Okay. God forbid they be the chairman. I don't want to be chairman, right? It'll be office of president. And our private sector, we don't have 1,000 people, right? Only two. One agriculture. So we meet six people. Customs is in front of us, right? Not 25 people, kanya-kanyang point of order, may anim lang kami. Malalim, dalawang oras yan. Ano ba nangyaga ganyan? Ano, we talk to the president. Natatakot sila. President kami. I was the president, di ba? Po, no? I mean, you can have a council, but you must have a small committee about six people, right? Okay? But if you get, let me tell you this, incidentally, Mr. Salceda, into the farmers, for God's sake, of course, I represent the farmers today. I used to represent cement. I represent the farmers today. I follow Mr. Fausto, I follow anyway. I'm just saying that one agriculture, one industry, 40 parts, yan ang totoo. Pwede kaunti marami. Democratic. Pero ang mga dyan, if you want livestock, and everyone will complain. You waste your time with the complaints. You can have that if you want to waste. You can have that. But you need a small, I'm saying, see what works. There's six people. And you know, we caught the top congressman. We caught big fish. And that's why they were scared of us. That if you look at the record, when we abolished the smuggling, shot up to more than double. Mr. Rosendo Soto is my good friend. I think he's one of the best in smuggling. Maybe he should be the one in agriculture. I don't know. No, I don't know. Because I also like Paying Mariano. I don't know who you're going to put in there. I'm just saying that let us have a working group, not an theoretical group. Not going to count here. Once a year. Once a month. Huh? You know, I hold my peace like I'm dead. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Karen. Kong Briones.
Madam Chair, can we go to the,
This one, before we go there, Kong Briones, this one, are you referring to a smaller council that meets like apart from the council itself?
Madam, it's up to you what you want to do. I believe in a small ex-com to recall the council, which is bigger. I'm just saying that you need a small group, call it an ex-com. I really want a committee. Committee, that's what I want. But if you're on a council, that's fine with me. But you must have a small group that will talk in depth. If I'm customs commissioner, I have 25 people there. I'll spend my time dribbling. They're dribbling the ball. If you have six people, they cannot dribble the ball. So I hold my peace. No, I'm just saying that you can have 1,000, you can have 20, whatever. I mean, whatever is fine, right? But if you don't have that small committee, it will not work. It will not work because when customs comes, you want them to meet 25 people. Good luck. And if that is the secretary, good luck talaga. Yan ang sure failure. The reason I know this, madam, is because I was in and I saw it succeed. And they tell me, Senator Pinats told me, you cannot mention smuggling. Of course you can. Don't you look at your work. Rosendo and I will talk. You know the United Nations. You know you spent another $2,000. You had in addition to what is discounting, you know, the product and all that, etc. So, madam, I'll talk to you offline. Offline, I can tell all the details. The same way I talked to So and Salt and all that. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Representative Rubianes.
Yeah. Can we go to the task force?
Yes, we may. As long as the group is already in agreement in terms of the composition of the council, so nine from the government, five from the private sector.
Okay.
Okay. We'll move to please move to the next slide. Okay. Go ahead, Representative Briones.
Yeah. May I suggest that the composition of the task force will be only coming from the National Bureau of Investigation, PNP, Coast Guard, and DA Inspectorate and Enforcement. Considering na ito ay talagang enforcement and supposed to be independent sa custom. Kasi sa tingin lang ng mga nasa sektor, dapat talaga yung enforcement ay considering that yung Department of Finances nasa council na. So, pagdating sa enforcement, NBI, PNP, Coast Guard and the Inspectorate and Enforcement.
Representative Swanson.
Looking at the Executive Committee composition of the Presidential Anti-Smuggling Group, the Bureau of Customs is always present because they have these visitorial powers. So yung hindi mapasok ng DA, napapasok ng customs through visitorial powers. So looking at the previous EXICOM composition of the Presidential Anti-Smuggling Group, we have the presidential representative or advisor, commissioner of customs or representatives, the chief of staff or his representatives, chief PNP or his representatives, director of NBI or his representative, chief state prosecutor of the National Prosecution Service, commandant of the Philippine Coast Guard, general manager of the Philippine Ports Authority, Director General of the National Intelligence Coordinating Agency. That's the composition of the PASG. Now, we can add DA because this is anti-smuggling of agriculture products, Madam Chair. So those were the members of the Executive Committee during the term of President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. So I leave it to the wisdom of the committee kung ano pang composition na gawin natin dyan.
Thank you, Congressman Swanson. The one that's missing is DTI. On the part of DTI, do you have like a counterpart for the DA Inspectorate Division? So do you have like a an enforcement arm within the DTI?
Oh yes po. Madam Chair, actually I'm from the Fair Trade Enforcement Bureau. So basically that responsibility revolves around that bureau or bureau.
So it's called the Fair Trade Enforcement Bureau.
That's right, Paul.
And looking at the overlap between the suggestion of Representative Briones and Representative Swen Singh, so on both, the NBI is there, the PNP, the PCG, and DA. The addition would be, I guess, on the part of the PASG, the presidential advisor is the chairman of the task force, the head. And then the rest are members. So in addition, it suggested that DOC, the AFP, the chief prosecutor, the representative from the Philippine Ports Authority, and the NICC, the the National Intelligence Coordinating Authority, also be included. And then DTI, the DTI Fair Trade Enforcement Bureau. Let's see, we have
11
members, yeah, thus far.
Madam Chair, this executive committee will be handling the day-to-day activities of the task force. So mas mabuti na yung kumpleto ang interagency representatives para mabilis yung operations.
Mm.
Madam Chair, with due respect with Kong Francine, previously meron tayong PASG. Totoo yun. Pero tingin ko sa dami ng members ng task force, naka-broadcast tayo kanilang operation. So at kung mapapansin natin during that time, naging effective lang yung task po, ay ang PASG noong panahon ni General Esperon. Dahil talagang nagbabantay siya sa custom, may mga military doon, yung PASG mismo. Kaya pinatag nila lahat ng dumarating ng mga container. Doon talaga, within siguro 3 months, halos nabawasan ng malaki ang smuggling. Pero after that, na iba na yung humawak. Wala eh. Siguro, dahil nga yung sobrang laki ng task force yung para sa enforcement, considering naman na meron tayo ditong function ng to inspect warehouses versus commodities are stored. Ibig sabihin, nandun na yung dapat gawin. Yung custom, hanggat maaari, maging independent itong task force. Kasi binigay na natin during the previous law, yung anti-agricultural smuggling law, yung sole power na manghuli. We have 7 years. Wala kahit isang nakulong o nakasintensyahan. So kami sa sector, ika nga ay medyo wala kaming kumpiyansa. Considering din ang custom naman, meron ding right to investigate etcetera to sa Custom Modernization and Tariff Act. So talagay ko dito sa subukan natin itong yung mismong enforcement at yung pwedeng mag talagang sanay sa investigation. Like for example, NBI, PNP, yung Coast Guard, and sila talaga yung nasa enforcement. Parang tayo nag-create ng yung council, yun yung nandun ang lahat ng kailangan. Pero doon sa operation, dapat siguro huwag masyadong marami. Tama na itong kumari, itong apat na ito, okay na ito, Madam Chair.
Congressman Swen Singh?
Yeah. I agree with Congressman Briones. Yung composition dati ng PASG, talagang hindi perfect.
Laki.
Talagang alam natin yan. Ngayon, ito lang ang, ito kasing task force, ang their task to do the day-to-day operations. Ang problema lang dito, Kong, kung may problema relating to yung mga values, mayrapan ang task force mag-connect sa customs. So, kung meron ng representative, mapapabilis ang operations process. Yun lang naman ang purpose ko dito sa customs. Kasi on its own, ang BOC can go after the smugglers. Meron yan, may mga visitorial powers yan. Kompleto na yan eh. Ang dito lang sa atin, yung mapapadali lang yung day-to-day operations ng task force. Kasi kung may tatanungin sila anong value ng commodity na ito, eh kung walang representative yung BOC dyan, mahirapan. Looking at the Senate version, meron BIR. So, kung may BIR, kakambal yung ano eh, BOC. So, depende na yan sa oversight function siguro ng Congress kung paano i-monitor itong mga members ng task force na gagawin natin. So, siguro Madam Chair, tingnan nyo na lang kung anong maganda. Dadaan pa naman tayo sa BICAM dyan, pag-usapan. Basta ang importante lang on the cartel aspect, yung sa mga valuation, transaction value, at least may representative lang yung customs na magbigay ng input. Yun lang naman sa akin. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Representative Briones. Thank you very much, Representative Swansin. So the way that I can see, I looked at the Senate version. For example, we can trim it down. Halimbawa, you have a representative from the Bureau of Fisheries and the DA Inspectorate Office. Pero kasi yung Bureau of Fisheries is already an attached agency of DA. But is there jurisdiction already currently covered by the DA Inspectorate Office that is there something that the Bureau of Fisheries would cover that's not already covered by the DA Inspectorate Office? Hindi ba bilang mother agency po ng BIFAR covered na ng DA both agriculture and fisheries? So medyo may redundancy lang in that regard. That's one thing that I saw. On the part of we have the BIR here, we have the BOC here. Because in the current version that we have in our working draft, we didn't include BIR. Is there something that, is there, would the enforcement arm of the BIR need to be included in the task force? BIR?
Your Honor. Yes, we have. We have in the National Investigation Division.
Kasi nakikita po namin dito, the BIR can add value in terms of hunting down the PACO.
Yes. Usually ma'am, tandem kami ng DOC po.
Mm-hmm. So to Congressman Swansing's point, if the BIR is part of the task force, then the BOC also needs to be part of the task force, Representative Briones.
I don't think BIR can be part of the task force next. Considering ito yung seizure, ito investigation. So, at kailan sabi ko nga, very lean. Kasi kinakalan yung kanilang pinag-uusapan, ilan lang yung nakakaalam sa operation. Total naman, yung custom ay represented na noong Department of Finance sa council. And then pwede rin naman natin ilagay na kung may kailangan other agencies na necessary, ay saka lang ipatawag. Parang something like that.
Ano po kasi, Romulo Briones, I also, like Congressman Swansing, feel very strongly that the BOC should be part of the task force because they already have, intrinsically, they already have the powers of the task force. So I feel very strongly about including the DOC as part of the task force. Ko lang on the part of PIRP also need to include them.
Madam Chair, I think the reason why the Senate includes the BIR is that they have this run after the tax evaders, yung rape. Tapos sa customs naman, may batas. Meron silang run after the smugglers. Kaya itong dalawang agencies na to, may ready mechanism na sila to prosecute yung smugglers. So para bang including, if you include these two bureaus, meron ka na ngipin agad. Yun siguro ang tingin ko lang dito. Ha. So yan siguro basically, Madam Chair, ang rason kung bakit sinali yung BIR. Para kung hindi man sila mahuli sa akto, pwede sila abulin sa ibang avenues ng prosecution. That's all, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Representative Spencing. I'm trying to draft like a suggested composition for the task force. Hindi ko alam kung sino sa PSG Philippine Ports Authority. I want to ask the BOC, if we don't include the PPA in the task force, would it hamper the speed by which you can actually operate in the ports?
Enforcement, Your Honor, I'll have to be honest that we actually do are able to have access to any ports operating in the country without any prior authority coming from the Philippine Ports Authority. So I really don't know the value yet of why PPA was included. Maybe it's for the reason that some data might be within the purview of the PPA, and being a member of the task force, those data may be easily secured easily by the task force if PPA is included. But on enforcement activities, I've yet to see much value, Your Honor.
Thank you very much, ASCOM.
Madam Chair.
Representative Sponsing, and then we'll go to Mr. Song.
I think the reason why PASG was the PPA was included during the time PASG was that it's not during the time the container movements is still not online. Siguro yun lang ang basic na rason. Pero ngayon kasi interlink na yan with the Bureau of Customs at saka Aras Street Services, kaya hindi na siguro kailangan ng PPA, Madam Chair.
Okay. All right, Mr. Song.
I want to know, no? Itong task force ba kailangan yung power ng custom tsaka power ng DIR bago makapasok dun sa isang lugar? O mag-create tayo ng may power yung task force? Kasi kung may power yung task force, pwede nang pumasok din, no? Dun sa area.
But then
sa power yung task force,
it's the expertise, the capability, the data that's on hand by the DIR and the BOC that's not readily available to the task force. I recognize your point that we can deputize the task force to have the powers that are currently seated in BOC and DIR. But I really see the value including these two agencies, BOC and DIR, because they already have the ongoing programs, the schemes, the network, the intelligence, the data, the capability to actually move fast.
Inaano ko, no? Ang point na linalabas ko, itong task force ba kung mag-implement yung power niya, kailangan pa yung power ng BOC and BAI?
It's not a question of the power, Mr. Saul. We're talking about the capability, the intelligence, the network, the manpower of the BOC. That's the personnel. They have people in the ports. They have people at the airports. lahat ng entry and exit points ng bansa, meron na pong tao yung DOC, which the task force would not be able to mobilize as quickly kung wala po yung DOC at BIR doon po sa task force. Yun lang yung point. Yung power po kasi, I understand the power, we can include in the law that one of the powers will be visitorial powers. You have all those. Pero po, we already have the network in place. Eh. So why do we want to exclude these two agencies that are already running after the smugglers and the evaders po, as things stand now? Congressman Franzen.
Madam Chair, I know about the concern of Congressman Briones here. Talaga marami nasusunog dati sa operations during past G. Sa tingin ko sa formulation ng IRR, madress natin lahat 'yon. Kung hanggang saan lang ba ang function ng dalawang agencies na ito. Siguro doon na Congressman Briones, doon madress natin 'yon. Kasi kung medyo takot tayo doon sa operational aspect, pwede naman natin gamitin yung personnel ng Coast Guard or ng PNP or ng Armed Forces. Depende.
Madam Chair.
Congressman Briones.
So, kami naman, medyo talagang na-experience kasi natin 7 years, walang nangyari. Under the ng custom. So, ang iniisip natin dito, pwede naman silang isama, ipatatawag na lang, pero hindi permanent part of the task force. Kasi ang operation talaga, dapat may secrecy yan eh. Para makahuli ka, pero kung nag-uusap lang, nag-leak na yung mga information, magagaya na naman tayo, may batas tayo na wala rin resulta. So yun ang nakakatakot do sa kapag masyadong marami ang members ng task force. Kung natin, yung council, lahat ng concern nila mapapag-usapan do sa council eh. Kaya nga, kailangan natin magkaroon ng council eh. Pero pagdating sa operation, dapat talaga yun lang sanay sa operation ang members niyang task force, which is independent to sa mismong sabi ko nga, meron naman silang power do sa Custom and Tariff Modernization Act na kanila. Kung gusto nila sila yung manghuli, manghuli sila. Pero pagdating dito, tingin ko ay napaka-importante. At saka dito sa bill na pinail ng Senate na tayo isa sa parating part ng resource speaker, talagang hindi kasama ang Bureau of Custom. Ang kasama lang NBI, PNP, Coast Guard, Port Authority, yung Philippine Ports Authority, DA Inspectorate, sabi mo nga kung pwedeng yun na lang, and then Bureau of Internal Revenue. And nilagyan pa nila ng representative from the concerned agriculture sector in case may kasi kung kailangan ni expertise, siguro yung expertise ng mga nasa sector kung paano madidetermine kung anong klaseng karne yan, siguro mas dapat pa yung ginawa ng Senate. At merong dito sa kanilang bill, merong secretariat, yung sinasabi kanina, and then merong special prosecutor. So hindi kailangan yung talagang nag-ano ng special prosecutor, special team of prosecutors. So, yun ang ang concern. For so many, lahat ng nasa sector, talagang naubusan na ng...
Pero, Compromise, I already raised that during the last hearing. We're giving police powers to the task force.
Yeah.
And we're putting in private sector to have police powers. So yun po, that's why we feel very strongly. I saw the Senate version wherein there's private sector in the task force. I would have to push back on that kasi po may police powers itong task force natin.
Okay naman ako na hindi kasama yung sector doon sa task force.
Opo.
Ang ano lang, pag mapapagaya nga ito sa past Gina, sa dami ng members ng task force, eh walang resulta. At patuloy na nag-ihirap yung ating mga partner. At ngayon ay nagkukulang ng supply. At yan ang dahilan kung bakit napakamahal na ating bilhin. Kaya kailangan, dapat pusin na natin yung magiging problema pa ulit-ulit. Ako since 2001, ito na ang ating panawagan. Smuggling, sobra importation. Sipin mo hanggang ngayon walang nangyayari. So hopefully with this bill at maging batas na minamadali naman ng ating presidente, talagang maging effective. Kasi kung hindi rin magiging epektibo ito at walang resulta, hindi pa rin babalik ang tiwala at sigla ng nasa sektor na agrikultura, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Representative Briones. I think the way that we could go about this, I have here a list of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 members which I will bring to the body and then we can just decide whether or not to include them. So you have the representative from the Office of the President, DOC, BIR, PNP, NDI, Coast Guard, BA, TTI, and then you have two which we got from the past G, which we can either include or not. We have Nika and the Chief Prosecutor. Those are the 10. And then we can decide. We'll just have a conference. Then we can suspend it. Okay, so as agreed, this will be the composition of the Anti-Agri-Fishery Commodities and Tobacco Economic Sabotage Task Force. So the lead would be the Department of Agriculture Inspectorate Office, DA. Please take note, we're making you the lead of the task force. Members be the BOC, BIR, PNP, NBI, Coast Guard, and DTI. And we will add a provision, if necessary, the task force may seek the assistance of concerned government agencies, sectors, and other stakeholders. That will be the composition of the task force. We will then also retain that the task force shall report every quarter to the council, unless we want to increase the frequency by which the task force will report to the council,
or as may be
necessary. We can add that. Okay. The powers of USIC will just update you po in terms of the composition of the council. Janina, let's show USIC the composition of the council. Task force yan. Where's the council? Yung kanina. The chair of the council will be the office of the president or the president's newly appointed representative. And then 9 members po, DOF, DOF, DA, DTI, DILG, DOJ, PCC, and DOTR. Based on the composition of PASG po. And then in the version currently agreed on, there will be 5 representatives from the private sector, from sugar, rice, corn, vegetable, and fruits, from livestock and poultry, from fisheries, and then from tobacco, yung 5. And then the private sector will nominate, I will submit 3 nominees from each of the 5 sectors identified, and then from which the president will select which nominee will be part of the council po. So 9+5 po yun sa atin. Okay. All right. So yeah, that's the council and the task force. So I would just like to solicit the comments of the body, because we're also providing for the establishment of a congressional oversight committee to evaluate the implementation of the act, and also, I guess, just to do check-ins with the council and the task force in terms of effectivity. One question that we have, so the current proposal is to establish a new congressional oversight committee, specifically to address this. So However, I saw the Senate version. Their suggestion is to leverage on the existing COCAFAM. So I would like to solicit the wisdom of the body, whether you would like a new congressional oversight committee or use the new one. The problem with COCAFAM, as we all know, it hasn't been convened. So at least this one, the way that we've structured the oversight committee in our proposal is that this new congressional oversight committee for anti-agri-fishery commodities and tobacco smuggling needs to be convened within 6 months from the effectivity of the act. And if we leverage on COCAFAM, given that it's already established, we won't be able to mandate that. Yun lang po yung reason kung bakit I'm more inclined to establish a new one para makadikta tayo na kailangan siya i-convene within a certain amount of time.
Madam Chair,
Kapaeng.
May proposal po ako. Pwede siguro nga mag-compose ng oversight committee yung concern, yung appropriate committees of Congress, of both houses of Congress, halimbawa, the Committee on Agriculture and Food sa House, and the Committee on Agriculture and Food, ano pa ba yun? Ang haba kasi yun. ng Senate. So, sino na lang ang ng Oversight Committee. Kumbaga, bago yung the whole, kasi ang talagang Congress naman may oversight function. Okay? Pero as para lang dito, mainam din na hindi rin yung COCAFAM kasi marami ng ano yun eh. So, yung Oversight Committee will be composed of appropriate committees from the appropriate committees of both houses of Congress. Ganun na lang. Para din may yung appropriate committees of Congress. Ayaw ko naman pangunahan yung Congress kung sino. Ako naman, most probably, ay yung committee, ang appropriate committees naman dyan, yung Committee on Agriculture and Food sa House at yung Committee of Agriculture and Food sa Senate. Kung i-refer natin yung appropriate committees of both houses of Congress.
Thank you very much, Kapaeng. Actually, yung pinakita sa akin ni Comsec ngayon lang, tinitignan namin yung provision na nag-establish ng COCAFAM dati. So, exactly to what you said, Kapaeng, naglagay na Committee on Agriculture dito, Committee on Agriculture doon, tapos 6 members dito, 6 members doon. So, well, when we draft the provision for our bill, we'll pattern it na ganun po. So, we'll designate the Committee on Agriculture and Food here and there. Or if we want, we can do three from Ways and Means, 3 from Agri and Food, just because Ways and Means has oversight then the oversight function as well. We'll play around with that po, pero perhaps yun po yung nasa isip ko, top of mind lang po, na pwedeng 3 from Ways and Means, 3 from Agri, then sa kanila Finance and Agri. So 12 members, 6 from each chamber.
Okay na yun.
Madam Chair. Madam Chair.
Without preference to
COCAFAM. Yes, Mr. So.
Pwede ba natin i-string down yung 6 months? Baka pwede 1 month na lang yung sa period kasi kaya naman tapusin yan sa isang buwan.
Kasi po yung IRR, yung pinapoint out po niyo sa, kasi what we have there as reference date is the effectivity of the act. So it already takes the IRR kasi we provide 90 days. So ano na po kaagad yun, 3 months na yun kaagad. Opo. So, yun lang po yung limitation natin. As much as I completely agree, gusto natin agad-agad makonvene yung Congressional Oversight Committee. Although, dito po sa council at saka sa task force, binagyan natin agad eh.
Immediately ba?
Immediate
po. Yung sa council at saka sa task force, yung pag-go po ng council and task force is immediate. Immediate after the effective, siguro after the IRR, after, so we can put 90 days po doon sa council and task force. May lang po tayong limitations kasi may IRR pa po tayo na period.
Gagawin na rito. Ganun ba yun?
Hindi po. Pag nakasa na po yung batas, It's, at saka po tayo magde-develop na IRR. And we have 90 days after the law is signed to develop the IRR.
Sino ang gagawa ng IRR? Anong department?
Diyan po, nasa provision po natin, dyan po sa ating House Bill ngayon, kung sino yung mga ahensya na isasama natin sa pag-develop ng IRR.
Pero yung Congress and Senate din ang ano?
Nakalagay po dito DOF, DA, DTI, DOJ. Consultation with concerned agencies and stakeholders.
Yeah, consultation pero hindi kagaya yung 10845 na ang DOF ang gumawa. Tama, no?
Ano po, kasi in general po kasi ang IRR is led by the government agencies. Several government apo will it's DA na lang po instead of DOF for those apo. Okay. Sige po. So okay na tayo sa council, sa task force, sa oversight. So we'll just refine it further. And then balik lang po tayo dun sa yung sa cartelizing. Kasi po ano, Madam Chair, the other congressman had to go away. So yes, from which department?
From BBM po. Just an additional comment for the council po. Considering na currently po, wala pa po tayong parang provision or language regarding who will do the secretariat and technical admin for the council. Considering that this is a policy-making body, it is important to assign a particular agency who will lead in terms of the secretariat.
As discussed a while ago, ma'am, DA, that will be DA. The secretariat for the council will be DA. And the lead for the task force would also be DA inspector.
Thank you so much for the clarification, Chair. But that is also our recommendation that it should come from the organic personnel of the DA.
We understand it's always the objection of the DBM. Don't need to create new positions. But we'll follow the wording of the advice of the DBM and we'll add wording specifically for secretariat.
Yeah, thank you.
We have other items around cartelizing, but I think that that's okay na? Okay na po. Natapos na yung discussion ng task force. Opo, sige po. Okay, so the other ones we've already discussed previously. Sige na po. With regard to open item around cartelizing, we'll just confer with the OSG and the PCC. I think it's a matter of semantics, just to do or instead of semicolon. So I feel that that's something that we can resolve offline.
Yeah.
Here, in terms of the penalties, we've already amended it based on the discussion from last time. So, increasing it from 2 times to 6 times the fair market value. It's just the same across the board. That's what we changed all throughout. We've already agreed last time in terms of the penalties. So, we're increasing the penalties to a minimum of 30 years.
Madam Chair, if I may.
Yes, Atty. Pataho.
Apologies for having to go back to the definitions. I just wanted to raise a while ago that I just have a small comment when it comes to profiteering, which we didn't go through this morning, this morning, yeah.
Yes, because we all thought that we were all in agreement from the last technical working group, right?
Yes, Madam Chair. But what happened then was when we had the last technical working group, because of the omnibus motion that I mentioned on the inclusion of tobacco in all, it's only now that it became apparent that there might be an issue when it comes to subparagraph D, particularly on the prima facie evidence of profiteering, the increasing of price by 10%. Our concern, Madam Chair, is that when we talk about cigarettes, we have an annual increase of excise tax, so that will affect our pricing. So every year our prices increase, but that's not because of our own choice, but it is a function of the increase of taxes.
I understand. So with the 10%, so your concern is what if it falls within the month of the increase?
Yes, Madam Chair. So if I may suggest, just to make it parallel with the definition of cartelizing, can we just add a qualifier, like whenever entities unreasonably raise prices, or to make it really parallel, artificially or unreasonably raise prices, so that at least that will give us some leeway to at least defend our actions.
My thought there, if the specific concern is around that particular month wherein the scheduled increases happen, why can't you just add the qualifier? Kasi yung 10% kasi is a good gauge from an enforcement standpoint, but we need to have that 10% there.
Yeah.
Siguro we can find some wording wherein in the case of tobacco, there's an exception if it falls within the month of the schedule increase or something like that.
Or something.
So we can do that because I'm hesitant to remove the 10% because that's very important from an enforcement standpoint. But we can make a qualifier for tobacco. And I thank you for raising that point. That's very valid.
Thank you for that, Chair.
Okay. So we'll also perhaps we'll draft something or JTI
we can
submit something. I think it's safer if you do it from your end, since you're more familiar with the way the scheduling works and how prices change after the scheduling works.
Definitely. Okay. Thank you.
Noted on that. Manabat.
Yes, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, I would like to request we have some comments with respect to the definition of Section 4 and 4-A on the crimes covered by the law. Particularly on Section 4.
I think before I go to that, Ms. Manabat, I think Mr. Ambrose has a comment. We have a comment? Because in media, tobacco related as well. So before we move to another section.
Actually, Madam Chair, it's also related with Section 4 and 4A.
Not on the definition,
no,
right?
No, ma'am.
Or profiteering for tobacco.
No, ma'am.
Okay. All right, so perhaps I can give it first to Ms. Manabat and then Attorney Ambrose.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, on Section 4, on the lines or involving tobacco, whether manufactured or unmanufactured, we propose to delete the phrase including finished products such as cigars, cigarettes, or heated tobacco products, because when you look at the definition of terms under Section 3E, tobacco is already defined to include both manufactured and unmanufactured. And the phrase limiting to finished products such as cigars, cigarettes, or heated tobacco is precisely the definition of manufactured tobacco. So just to lessen the provision of the on the first paragraph.
We'll refer that back to JTI. Would it be amenable to removing it there since we've extensively defined tobacco in the definition of terms?
Just to clarify, Madam Chair, so it will read or involving tobacco with the minimum excise tax and VAT payable.
No, it's or involving tobacco, whether manufactured or unmanufactured, with the minimum excise tax.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. Actually, we can also remove whether manufactured or unmanufactured, since 3E
already mentions in the first paragraph that tobacco refers to both manufactured and unmanufactured.
Yes, I agree also.
Noted. Before I accept the amendment, we'll first go to Attorney Ambrose.
Same provision of Section 4 and 4A, Madam Chair. Just a suggestion to qualify the minimum fair market value as minimum aggregate fair market value, because there might be an instance that would be perpetrator just to prevent or avoid the prosecution for economic sabotage would tend to divide bill of ladings into smaller amounts. I think the Bureau of Customs is aware of this, because there are shipments, all shipments are divided into several bill of ladings. So I suggest that we use aggregate after the word minimum. Minimum aggregate fair market value. And additionally, Your Honor, if I may suggest to clarify that it's not only one agricultural product, so it may be a combination of two or more.
Sorry, the first is clear. So that one we put aggregate before fair market, so minimum aggregate fair market value. Is there a particular area that you want to change to incorporate your second comment? Yung difference in commodities, diba?
Maybe it's just a phrase. It can be inserted anywhere, but to specify that it's not only one particular agri-fishery product, but maybe a combination, but the minimum will be 1 million pesos.
Okay, we'll figure out where to put it, but I understand or something like a combination thereof of the products. So we'll figure out where to put it. Off the top of my head, hindi ko ma-figure out saan eh. Pero we'll figure it out. Noted. So based on the comments, so just to reiterate, the first is we'll remove under section 4. We'll word it as follows: with a minimum aggregate fair market value of 1 million pesos or involving tobacco with a minimum excise tax and VAT payable in the amount of 1 million pesos is committed to any of the following acts. So that already incorporates the two comments, the comments from JTI, from the NTA, and from the OSG. And then we'll wait for the wording from JTI with regard to profiteering for tobacco. Yes, Mama Nabat.
Yes, Madam Chair. If we may go to Section 4A, I have also the same suggestion to remove also the phrase whether manufactured or unmanufactured, including finished products such as cigars, cigarettes, or heated tobacco products.
So we'll copy it accordingly. Here we'll also put minimum aggregate fair value. It's there as well. And then we'll also change involve tobacco with a minimum excise tax and VAT payable, et cetera, et cetera. So whichever changes we made to Section 4 will also adopt similarly to Section 4A. Yes, Munabat.
Yes, Madam Chair. On hoarding, Section 4AA, from the definition of hoarding, it contemplates three acts. One is undue accumulation. Second is unreasonable limitation or refusal to dispose, sell, or distribute. And the third is unjustified taking out. But in the second paragraph, for purposes of establishing a prima facie evidence of hoarding, on the first act, it is clear, because when entities have stocks 50% higher, it covers the first act. But on the second mode of committing hoarding, the second paragraph uses the phrase unreasonably limit, refuses, or fails to sell. But if you look at the definition, it should be unreasonably limit or refuse to dispose of, sell, or distribute. Just to avoid a vagueness in the difference in the couching of the phrase, because the verb fail is not included in the definition. So I humbly suggest that in the creation and in the establishment of a prima facie evidence, we also adopt the same phrase as unreasonably limit or refuse to dispose of, sell, or distribute.
Sorry, Ms. Mala, but let me just see where we can incorporate that. There shall be prima facie evidence of hoarding when entities have stocks of any agricultural commodities or tobacco 50% higher than their usual inventory and unreasonably
limit or refuse to dispose of
or refuse to dispose of
distribute. Madam Chair, we simply
or distribute
the definition in A, because in A we use the verbs limit or refuse, but in the prima facie evidence we use three verbs: limit, refuse, or fail. The verb fail does not appear in the definition in the first paragraph. So just to adopt the same definition, there is a prima facie evidence of hoarding when the entities unreasonably limit or refuse to dispose of, sell, or distribute the same.
Yes. I also, from a prosecution standpoint, it's a little bit difficult to qualify refuses to sell. How would you also? So I agree. Accepted. We'll adopt. Mataas masyadong ceiling. The definition for profiteering came from the PCC, or was it DTI for profiteering?
Volume.
Hoarding.
Ang hoarding. Dapat yung minimum volume, average volume dapat.
Okay. Any other major, let's see. Oh, okay. 526. So this is an important addition in the part of the presumption, any public officer or employee whose name, initials, or signature, whether web, digital, or electronic. The previous version only included physical signatures, or we didn't even specify. But a lot of the agencies now are using online systems, electronic systems. So we want to make sure whichever digital footprint you have, you're actually, you know, that can serve as prima facie evidence. Next, council. Expanding the list of agencies that can institute cases. So here, this was already agreed upon during our previous technical working group. So instead of the case now, we're in to get the approval of the Commissioner of Customs for you to be able to lodge cases, we're expanding the number of agencies that can lodge cases. So we have the BOC, the NBI, DTI, DA, and the PCC. So this was agreed upon during the last technical working group. And then the PCC suggested below, just to add that it doesn't repeal their jurisdiction based on existing law. So we'll add that paragraph. Yes, Mr. Fausto.
Madam Chair, can we not include also the private sector with the ability to file cases if yes. There are
so actually
groups, farmers groups, or
so this was raised actually by Mr. Kainlet during our last TWG. Ang napag-usapan po namin and nag-agree naman na po yung private sector during the previous meeting that they can lodge cases through either the NBI or the OSV. So hindi po na yung private sector yung directly maglo-lodge yung cases, but rather they can do it through the NBI or the OSG.
So we need to go through the OSG before we can file case.
You can opt for the easier route would be NBI.
NBI.
Opo, you can lodge it through the NBI, and then the NBI would file it on behalf.
Okay.
Would you refresh lang? What was the rationale? What was our rationale during last TWG where we were saying that it's difficult for us to be able to allow the private sector to directly lodge? Meron tayong rationale from last time. I don't remember it.
Yes, Madam Chair. If my memory is correct, in the institution of complaints before the DOJ for the prosecution of crimes. In the previous committee hearing, I recall that the draft provision enumerates the government agencies that have the power to institute, but not the private individuals, because the rationale would be because the documentary evidence that would be attached to the complaint is in the possession of the government agency, considering that these agencies are also the members of the task force. So they will be the one who will do the investigation, the raid, the counterintelligence activities. But on the part of the private sector, if they have information that any of their competitors or any other entities are engaged in the prohibited acts by the law, they can report or go to the concerned agencies like the DA, the DTI, the BOC, and request and provide them information, and then these agencies can do the investigation to validate their complaints and then commence the initiation of complaint before the DOJ.
Mr. Pasco. Yeah. Thank you very much. But I forgot the exact rationale for this
there. But anyway, if the private sector will be filing cases against officials of government, who is supposed to be the one that she's talking about? Yes. Can we not do that as private?
There's a route for you to be able to lodge it through the NBI.
Okay.
So that was the agreement last time. Whether because the OSG raised actually that they won't be able to act without the parang they have to serve as the agent of the government. Eh. So the, for them to be able to represent government agencies need to mobilize them. So that's why we added the NBI so that the private sector and individuals can actually lodge po to the NBI. Tinitingnan ko ba po what other provisions we need, because I think we've gone through the most important ones. The rest of it we've already agreed on. So we have establishing the special team of prosecutors. So this was already agreed that right now there's an ad hoc within the DOJ that prosecutes cases with regard to smuggling, but we're trying to codify that, to institutionalize, so that that team would now be a permanent team. And then extending the application of the prescriptive period. So as discussed, the period of, this was already agreed upon during the last TWV, the period of prescription shall commence from the day of which the crime is discovered by the offended party, the authorities, or the agents, and shall be interrupted by the filing of the complaint or information, and shall commence again when such proceedings terminate without the accused being convicted or acquitted, or when such proceedings are unjustifiably stopped for any reason not imputable to the accused. So, and then, dinagdag ko last, from last time, di ba? Kasi last time, the letter S lang natin. Yung last time po, di ba, yung may letter S lang, the crimes punishable under this act shall prescribe in 20 years. Talk about the, ito na po yung tanong, Mr. So, kanina, with regard to who will be crafting the IRR. So we'll change this based on the suggestion of MUSEC. We'll put here first the DA as the first, and then DOF, DTI, DOJ, in consultation with concerned agencies and stakeholders. And then they need to promulgate the IRR within 30 days upon its effectivity. Yes, Ms. Manabat.
Yes, Mr. Chair. Actually, we've discussed this with Attorney Ong from the DOJ. I was the one who suggested the inclusion of the prescription of crimes under Section 12. Mm-hmm. But we have one comment. We suggest to delete the word, the complaint or, before the filing, to be rewarded as, and shall be interrupted by the filing of the information. Because this provision was directly lifted from Article 91 of the Revised Penal Code. But jurisprudence has already settled that the phrase, the filing of the complaint or information in Article 91 of the Revised Penal Code refers to the institution of the proper case before the proper court. So right now, under the rules on revised rules on criminal procedure, what initiates the proceedings before the court is the filing of the information and no longer the complaint. Okay. You lodge the complaint before the DOJ, and the DOJ has the information before the court. Thank you.
So may you please state the wording here, whichever we need to delete.
The period of prescription shall commence from the day on which the crime is discovered by the offended party, the authorities, or their agents, and shall be interrupted by the filing of the information.
Okay, so we'll just take out complaint or. Okay. Noted. Okay, we've gone through, yes, go ahead.
I apologize, Mr. Madam Chair. Can we go back to the penalties?
Do we want to open that up? What's the problem with the penalties? Sorry, I don't want to open the floor anymore.
Madam Chair, actually, it's just a minor comment.
Mm-hmm. Kasi akala ko settled na tayo sa penalties that was already closed during the last TWG.
Yes, Madam.
But okay, I will entertain.
Madam Chair, in Section 5A, it imposes the penalty, the highest penalty, which is life imprisonment and fine 6 times. The covered act would be all acts enumerated under Sections 4 and 4A, meaning all the crimes covered here, smuggling, hoarding, profiteering, cartelizing, and other acts of market abuse. But if you look into the subsequent section, paragraph, which is Section 5B and 5C,
5B imposes the penalty for the commission of the offense of knowingly selling, lending, leasing, assigning, consenting, or allowing the unauthorized use of import permits. Essentially, Madam Chair, this covers the current Section 3D of the law. But if you look at Section 4 now, on the definition of large-scale smuggling, it may be committed by any of the following acts. So the vagueness here would be Section 5A imposes the higher penalty of imprisonment for all the acts covered by Section 4 already. And Section 4 may be committed through various ways, paragraph A to paragraph L. But if you look at Section 5B, there is another penalty which is lower, meaning 30 to 39 years, if the commission is 3D, which is now under the proposed amendment, would appear as Section 4D. So if, and similarly with Section 5C, 5C numbers 1, 2, 3 covers the offense of transporting and storing smuggled commodities or tobacco, which is essentially covered by the provision of the current Section 3G of the law. Again, Madam Chair, in Section 5A, the higher penalty already covers all the acts of Section 4. So to avoid the vagueness in the imposition of the penalty, I humbly suggest that in paragraph A, after the phrase any of the acts enumerated under Sections 4 and 4A of this Act, except as otherwise provided below, to exclude the offense of Section 3D, which is now Section 4D, and Section 3G, now Section 4G.
Agreed. Akala namin kanya, we were all reacting here because we thought you would challenge the graduation of penalties. But I agree, it's a clear way to just delineate. So, accepted. Kinakabahan kami kanina, baka i-question ni Ms. Manabat yung graduation ng penalties. Apo, completely agree. Thank you very much for raising that. It's always good to get the perspective of the OSG and the DOJ, given that we're the ones handling these cases. So, again, what we want is to increase the conviction rate. So, kung ano man yung vagueness doon po sa law that you think would be an impediment to actually being able to prosecute and convict, please do let us know. Because that's really the intent. Okay. All right. That's it. All of the amendments that we felt we needed to bring back to the body already discussed. I think the most contentious today is the composition of the council, the task force, and the oversight committee. The other contentious, which I actually did not expect to be very contentious, would be the definition for cartelizing, which we've already fleshed out as well. There's just the point on hoarding, I believe, that we just need to settle between the OSG, was it profiteer? Yung may semicolon? The point around distract ako. Hoarding, dun sa semicolon issue. So, well, I'll let the PCC and the OSG settle that. And then I'll just wait for the JTI to give the additional phrasing for profiteering just to capture that nuance with regard to the scheduled price increase year on year. We'll also create the wording for the creation of the oversight committee. We have yet to draft that. We'll also draft the wording for the secretariat. We'll also flesh out the composition of the oversight committee. So pending pa po yun, but I think we're in agreement, keep it at 6-6, and then agri and ways and means for each of the two chambers. Any other open items?
Well, I want to ask, we'll solicit just very one last point for DTI and PCC on the definition of profiteering. Here, it refers to sale or offering for sale of any agri-fishing commodities or tobacco at a price grossly in excess of its true worth. So, true worth here is not defined. So, would we like to thresh that out? Kasi actually, medyo yun din yung hindi clear on the definition of true worth. Can we specify that? Is that the SRP? Is that the market value, transaction value? What's true worth? Because we lifted it off the definition in the Price Act.
Yes, well, actually, for the profiting definition, po, I believe this is actually lifted from the Price Act directly. And so it mirrors the definition under the Price Act. But specifically for true worth, po, can we get back to you on this so that we can actually check what the basis of for this, and so that we can categorically say that this figure is the basis for profiteering here.
Okay, no problem. I think you've seen the thrust, yes, for the bill. We have our own definitions. While we refer to specific, you know, provisions within the Price Act and in the PCA, we need the definitions here as well. We want this to be a standalone measure. So if we can also define true worth here, that would be better. So I'll also wait for the definition, yes, from DTI.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments from the body, from our stakeholders, from our resource persons? Ano po? I'm saying that as a closer, kasi po, this would be our last technical working group on this matter. This is this house operates under consensus. So I don't want anyone to come back and say na we were not heard during the meeting. So before we close the technical working group for the Anti-Agricultural Smuggling Act, I would give open the floor to anyone who has any other comments. Yes, Mr. Fausto.
Madam Chair, hindi lang maalis sa isip ko eh, because sa Nueva Ecija, we have this, bibili ka ng sibuyas, April, i-stock mo sa cold storage facility, iintayin mo tumaas yung presyo, hanggang lumabot siguro na 200 to 500, binili mo ng 60. You know this because we came on the same area and your mother is the ones fighting this. So is that not considered as hoarding? Because the definition of hoarding in this case is very general. Parang what I have in mind is something like if you bought domestic produce, if you buy some products produced domestically, and then you keep it in your warehouse or your cold storage facility. And is that not, and wait for a higher price, is that not market manipulation or price manipulation? It could be considered hoarding. Hindi malinaw sa akin, hindi lang mailipit maalis sa isip ko.
Madam Chair. Madam Chair, kasi ang problema is if the one in the cold storage facility operator will really hold on to the product, like especially onions, you know it very well, onions. Papataasin nila yung presyo, no? So it takes about 6 months. But what I'm trying to say is that if you buy products from the farmer, you buy it for 60, in 3 months, perhaps 50% of that product should be out already in the market, not holding it until it goes up, the price goes up. Kasi 6 months yung contract mo sa cold storage facility. So bibilin mo ng April, ilalabas mo na October. By that time, the price is really, you know, is that not part of the definition of the hoarding? So domestic produce natin. Kaya tumataas ang presyo. But if we can manage this, na a certain percent should be required to be out in the market. Kasi yung definition yun ng hoarding dito, if you have 50% more than your usual inventory, ano, hindi kasi malinaw lang. Hindi lang maalis sa isip ko na biggest cross. Yun.
Well, ano po, may I throw that question to Jay? Kasi sa amin, sa definition natin ngayon ng profiteering and hoarding, technically kasi, if we look at it based on the words talaga in the definitions here, that practice is considered hoarding and profiteering. And not profiteering, hoarding. But then 6 months po, ang tagal naman.
That's the practice in our place. In your place also. In Congressional District 1. April. Bibili niya ng April. October ilalabas. Pero.
Maximum yun. Pero you already said gradually.
Hindi nga eh. They will keep it. 6 months, you keep it. Kaya sabi ko, when you keep it and you don't release it, that's hoarding. Wala sa definition eh. Wala sa definition. You have to clarify that. Dapat yan, the law should specify that if you buy a product, dapat yung nasa warehouse mo at saka sa cold storage facility mo should be released gradually. Say 50% after 3 months should be out.
So, dapat naka-register.
Yes, that's why the next thing I would like to say is we have to require and all cold storage facilities and warehouses to be licensed before they are allowed to operate. Registration of all warehouses and cold storage facilities, including the capacities. Because if they are not registered, even the LGUs cannot monitor them. There are manipulations on the cold storage facilities.
I'm amenable to that. So we can include that there na may registration and monitoring. With regard to holdings, I was updated by ComSec Baby that yesterday during the inquiry on the hoarding of onions, Mayroon na pong thrust towards increasing the regulatory powers of the BPI such that they will evaluate the holding period, the current 6 months, may be shortened based on the inquiry.
Kasi meron ka ng this law, may definition ka ng hoarding. Kaya if you want to include it in this law, ilinabi mo dito sa batas na to, yung hoarding na yan. Madam Chair, if I may also add, yung CLAPS kasi seasonal eh.
Yes, Mr. Rafa, I'm very much aware of...
Yung CLAPS is seasonal. When the poultry has monthly, meron yan eh, may harvest. Pero yung CLAPS mo, seasonal. So, pwede nilang i-manipulate yan at i-hoard. And walang protection yung consumer dyan. Ang kikita dyan yung mga traders talaga. We need to regularize it to the sense na wag naman masyadong profiteering. Kaya umaabot ng 700 ang sibuyas mo.
PA Inspectorate, kayo po ba yung nanghuhuli ng hoarding ng onions?
No, Your Honor. That is the part of the mandate. We are on anti-agriculture smuggling, food safety, and price up.
So, DPI, are you the one running after hoarders?
Specifically onions po, I'm sorry.
Yes.
No po. The real retail...
Yes, but it's the DPI.
We participate po alongside the DA.
DPI, di ba? So, no. Sorry, I heard DPI. We're a plan. Oh, so that's under DA. Kaya lang...
Yes, ma'am. But we just the DPI only assist the DPI in the enforcement or in the interdisciplinary power.
Kasi yung sinasabi namin, as per the current wording of our law, yung described by Mr. Fausto really does constitute hoarding based on our current definition. So bilang yung kayo po yung mag-i-enforce, gusto namin maintindihan if this is okay. Kasi right now, our basis is the average for the last 3 months. Yun yung magkoconstitute ng hoarding. If your inventory goes above 50% of your average for the last 3 months.
As to the... Powers of the BPI.
Hindi po sa powers, sir. From an enforcement standpoint, hindi po ba kayo talaga at all involved sa panghuhuli ng hoarding ngayon? You won't be able to speak about that.
Hindi po sa hoarding. Madam Chair, sa Price Act, Republic of 7581,
tatlo ang implementing agencies. DA, kasama na yung BPI, ganyan-ganyan. And then DTI. And then DNR. Kasi yung mga tabla, ganyan. Tatlo yun eh. Kaya, ang DA ay isa doon sa implementing agencies na tatlo. Ngayon, usapin lang, sino ang dinesignate? Kasi nakalagay doon, DA, implementing agency, sa ilalim ng BPI. So, ako, intindi ko, BPI dapat i-delegate ng DA yung pag-i-implement ng Price Act as far as the DA is concerned. Kasi paano mo i-implement yung, paano mo i-define yung Section 5, yung definition ng illegal acts of price manipulation? Paano mo paano ka mag-i-institute ng, sasabihin mo doon sa, kung DOJ ang mag-i-institute ng pa-file ng complaint, malinaw yung penal provisions doon sa Section 15 on the Price Act of 9. Ando na yung kasing illegal acts of price manipulation sa Section 5 ng the Price Act. Andon, ano yun? Profiteering, hoarding, cartel. At prohibition yun. Yun yung pinag-alaw sa so dapat,
i-mention dyan.
Sa DA, yung BPI, kasi nakalagay din mismo kung ano yung sa ilalim ng DA as implementing agency, sino yung mga bureaus niya na mag-i-implement nung Price Act. So, yun sa doon yung BPI. Madam Chair.
We can refer, Madam Chair, yung provision ng hoarding definition dun sa Price Act.
Ngayon, kung meron na yung definition ng hoarding dito,
consistent.
This is also consistent with the Price Act. This came from a workshop of PCC and PCA. Based on the Price Act. Ito po kasi, I think dito papasok yung findings ng inquiry ng Committee on Agriculture and Food on onion hoarding. One of the main findings of the committee during the investigation is that yung thrust po is mag-increase yung regulation such that hindi na papayagan yung long-term na holding ng onions. While I understand that it's a current practice, I think yun po kasi yung one of the most important outputs of the inquiry that the period need to be shortened. To some extent, kailangan mag-release yung mga warehouses ng onion. So,
exactly.
If that's the case po, I think the current definition that we have now, which is should not exceed the 3 months, the average inventory of the 3 months preceding by 50%. I think that's permissible enough. Ano po siya? Kasi one of the directives of Chairman Mark Inverga to me when we convene the technical working group for anti-agri is to make sure na yung ano po, outputs ng investigation natin ng onion is incorporated here. And I think that's maybe one of the main thrusts po to shorten that period na hindi na iho hold for 6 months.
So I've not seen in the proposal the word cold storage facility or warehouses kasi I don't know it's different warehouse and a cold storage. Wala akong nakita cold storage facility word dyan sa
okay. So you we'll add no problem po Mr. Fausto, we'll do that. So wherever there's warehouses, we'll include cold storage where applicable. And then on top of that po, yung diniscuss po natin kanina, we'll also add that na magkakaroon na mandatory registration of all warehouses and cold storages for monitoring. Apa, duly noted po on the point. Pero to answer your question po, yung current practice na ngayon na hinuhold for 6 months from April to October, based on the current version of our bill, that would constitute hoarding. Pasok po siya. Yes, okay. Ma'am Guevara. Yung bill inventory, that is required to be submitted by our traders or our... Kasi ngayon po, medyo... Kung i-re-require po natin, kasama na rin dapat kung ni-register nila yung inventory kasi pwede po talaga nilang manipulatin din yung inventory. Thank you.
Yes. I was also updated by Comsec Baby that that's also one of the outputs from the investigation that there would now be a requirement for the registered
cold storages and warehouses to submit monthly reports of their inventory levels. So we're starting and ending inventory levels. Perhaps we can add that here. Kasi di ba may output yung investigation, this is the place for us to add it. So we'll include that as well. So registration as well as mandatory submission of reports or inventory levels. Any other concerns? Yes, Ms. Manabat.
Some minor suggestions, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, I would like to be clarified on section 4AA on hoarding. In the first paragraph, we used the phrase normal inventory levels. But in the second paragraph on prima facie evidence, we used the phrase usual inventory. So for clarification lang po, we suggest that we retain one phrase only, whether we use normal or usual inventory, because usual may be relative than normal. Mm-hmm. And then second minor comment, Madam Chair, is on section 9 on the powers of the council. Number 1, to prepare appropriate and effective measures. While prepare is, I humbly suggest that it is not a relative, it is a not relatively formal verb, but rather right. I suggest that we use the verb adopt.
Actually, I will actually be more straightforward about this define the policy direction for the task force or something to that effect. Medyo too soft.
Yes. Here. And then next, Madam Chair, on the powers of the task force on section 10, number 1 is to adopt. The delineation between the powers of the council is the one who adopts and the task force is the one who implements.
Right, to implement appropriate measures.
And then on section 11, Madam Chair, I understand in your previous statement earlier, the oversight committee will be created 6 months after the effectivity. So
yes,
instead of the word passage, we use effectivity, which is after the publication.
Actually, I said effectivity. Clerical error. Yes. Yeah.
On section 12, section 10, Madam Chair, just semantics on the third paragraph on institution and prosecution of criminal proceedings. All the laws there are referred to as Republic Act. So all throughout the provision of the law, we suggest that we retain the same and use implementing agencies under Republic Act 10667, open and close, Philippine Competition Act.
You're okay?
We're okay with that.
It's really just under semantics. Yeah.
And then lastly, Madam Chair, you mentioned earlier on section 13 on the implementing rules and regulations. You earlier stated that it would be promulgated 90 days from effectivity, but at the present draft, it's not amended. So if it's 90, we
use 90. We'll refer that question to Yusek. Yusek, yung IRR, what should we indicate within 60, 90, 60 days? So we'll edit it 60 days. We have 2 months.
To, 90 days
to make the IRR up.
That would be all, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Ms. Manabat. I will say it again. I very much appreciate the inputs. Kahit yung mga maliliit kasi, syempre po, we've been taking a look at this for months. So, pag hindi mo nakita. Opo. All right. I think for me, going to today's meeting, I was really worried about whether we're going to reach a consensus on the composition of the council and the task force. That was stretched out and I'm really happy about that.
Ma'am, it would be a good idea to adjourn already.
Yes, I'm also defending in the plenary for changes to the mining fiscal regime. It's my day two of interpolating, so I haven't slept in a week. Pero hawak ko po kasi I'm two of the SONA legislative measures, mining and anti-agricultural smuggling. I'm truly honored to be entrusted with such important legislative measures. Pero I agree with Attorney Enchong because I'm running late for my next meeting. But yes, I think we've opened the floor long enough for anyone else who has comments. Again,
my office, and of course the Committee on Agriculture and Food is always open as we develop the final output of the technical working group. Please feel free to please let us know if there are glaring problems that are still there so we can resolve it before we go to the mother committee. How quickly, Comsec Baby, are we going to have this approved? Okay, so according to USEC, we would the timeline is we'll have this approved by the mother committee next week. So take the bargain for senior USEC and specific Comsec. Okay, so again, just to close, I'm very grateful to everyone who participated in our technical working group and our two very lengthy technical working groups. In total, we spent, I think, 4.5 hours during the past technical working group and another 4.5 hours today. So 9 hours of work, in addition to the 2 hours of workshop na ginawa ng DTI, PCC, and the Committee on Agriculture and Food to work out some of the semantics and wording. So in total, 11 hours of work by this technical working group. And I also believe that everyone is well represented. All the government agencies who wanted to participate, the private sector who wanted to have a voice, were all heard and given a chance to speak in this committee. So I truly believe that the output of our technical working group is the best legislative measure that we could come up with from the side of the House and Congress. So I really would like to thank everyone for your time and your incredibly valuable inputs. As I said, we've been looking at this measure for the past couple of months, and there are things that we cannot see, or specific nuances that we couldn't spot, and we won't be able to address that without the very valuable inputs of all of the members and all of those that participated in our technical working group. To the government, to the private sector, to the different groups, and of course to the House members who participated over the course of the last 11-hour marathon meetings of the technical working group, I am truly, truly grateful. And please know that once we pass this into law, every single one of you who participated in this technical working group made a large role in creating a measure that would hopefully change the way that smuggling, hoarding, profiteering, and cartelizing is reduced and attacked in our country. And again, as I keep on saying, the goal really is to hunt down and finally make accountable the perpetrators that have long been doing these activities. And hopefully we're going to be able to give them the penalties and finally convict them make them accountable commensurate to what they've already taken out from the coffers of the Philippine government and whatever they've already taken out from the Filipino people and the consumers who had to bear the brunt of the price increases and all of the effects of supply shortages, all of these effects of hoarding, profiteering, cartelizing, and smuggling in our country. So that's a very long-winded way to say thank you to everyone who participated in our technical working group. Thank you very much. And finally, as everyone has been saying, I hereby adjourn the technical working group of the Anti-Agricultural Smuggling. Thank you very much.
kahit sa ang institution of higher learning. In fact, kahit nga sa high school and grade school, partner, meron tayong mga